Coming up this week on the MarkCast. Well, here we are. The XFL 2023 has completed its inaugural season. Congratulations to everybody that's involved. So now that we're done, it's time for a full, extensive, and exhaustive review of the XFL 2023 season. What did the XFL do right? What did the XFL do wrong? We have you covered with all the angles. First and foremost, XFL insider Mike Mitchell, deep dive with Mike as we always do. What is the XFL up to next? We have the XFL rookie draft coming up. What are Mike's thoughts?
It's not enough to say, oh, we completed our season, so we did great. That's, you know, that's a low bar. Unfortunately, it's a low bar we've seen in this space before. You know, leagues run out of $50 bills. You know, we've seen the AAF run out of funding and, you know, and all that. So it's, you know, the XFL 1.0 completed their season. XFL 2.0 would have. We know the story behind that. And so, yes, of course, tip of the cap to the XFL 3.0 for getting to the finish line. A lot of the financial decisions they made is so they can move on to a year two and a rookie draft and everything else that's coming, the fall draft and expanding of rosters to 90. So what they did in year one was to enable year two and three. So I totally get that. So, but you know, like I can't give it a 10 because there were certainly some missteps along the way.
Then Bill Shea of The Athletic, we have a full breakdown of the TV ratings for the XFL championship game, ad revenue versus the USFL. What does Bill think?
You start off huge. There is some churn as you lose viewers and you level out to whatever you think that's going to be. And then you, you know, fingers crossed, get a big number at the end for your playoffs and championship. Because of the structure of the XFL season, starting a week after the Super Bowl, all of a sudden you're dealing with, you know, the Masters and March Madness and things like that. You're the bottom of your U may be a little deeper. And, you know, everybody knew that going in.
And then from ESPN, we have Cole Kublik. Cole coming back on the podcast. Cole was at the championship game, at the playoff games as well. What did Cole make of ESPN's broadcast this year? Is ESPN happy with the XFL?
The ball was better. The atmospheres were better. The access was better. And I think the league is, talking to DJ and Danny a couple of times through the course of the year, like they're set up. They're set up to go multiple seasons. They're in this for the long haul. And I think if you can grow on what you had year one, technically year one, this thing's going to be a lot of fun to watch down the road.
And then from a football standpoint, we have Coach Himebauch coming back on the program. Jonathan Himebauch, offensive line coach for your XFL Arlington Renegades, world champions. What did Jonathan make of the season compared to his time in the USFL? What does it feel like to be a world champion? What would Jonathan like to see moving forward with the XFL?
I'll tell you what, man, I'm not a guy to get real nervous before games because it's kind of like as a coach, you've done your preparation, you trust your players, and you just want to make some adjustments as the game goes along. But I started thinking about this. I'm like, 22 years ago, I played in this. We won a championship. We had a blast. We had the best team in the XFL in 1.0 in 2001. And I was like, this could be pretty cool. I could be the only person to do this thing and do a back-to-back with 22 years in between.
And then for our friends up north, we have Football Canada President Jim Mullin coming on. Jim says he has hot takes on the XFL and the USFL. Plus, we are previewing the CFL 2023 season.
Quite frankly, I thought in terms of presentation, it was a bit of a wet firecracker. And what I mean by that is that, you know, for a championship game, I expect a level of energy to it.
And then listeners of the podcast have wanted to hear this gentleman on our show for years. We have McLeod Bethel-Thompson. We called him King of the CFL, you know, Grey Cup champion with the Toronto Argonauts. Now for the New Orleans Breakers, we are catching up with McLeod Bethel-Thompson, hearing about his time in the USFL.
Scratch tooth and nail up there, you know, in 2019, even when I led the league in touchdowns, you know, it's like, it's not like we had team success and it wasn't like it was an easy road to get there. And I'm appreciative of that. I like that. I like that nothing was given to me. And I like that the Argos challenged me every single year after that, you know, bringing in different competition the next year, different competition the next year. And it truly made me earn it. And more than anything, it made me build an inner confidence and an inner fortitude.
And then you've seen him on the field for the St. Louis Battlehawks. Now he is auctioning off autographed cleats for charity. We are catching up with Tré Watson, hearing about his time in the XFL 2023. Should be a long one. Hope you enjoy. Hey guys, welcome to the Marcast. Reed here. Going to get to this really quick today. I already previewed off the top. Tons of XFL 2023 recap stuff today. Seven guests. Tremendous work going into this. I really hope you guys enjoy it, appreciate it. I hope this is a little evergreen. I know obviously like McLeod's interview and things like that, little timely, but this is really exhaustive coverage here. All the angles. Where did Mike Mitchell think of the XFL season now that we have crowned the champion, talking all the angles with Mike, the TV ratings, coming, whether it's coming up in 2024, we have the rookie draft that was just announced today. What does Mike make about that? And the supplemental draft that should be coming here in the fall, what's next for the XFL? Lots of stuff with Mike. And then really talking, TV ratings with Bill Shea, really appreciate his time with The Athletic coming on, the TV broadcast angle with Cole Kublik, and then the football angle with Jonathan Himebauch. So I really hope you guys feel like you have, comprehensive here. What do we think of the XFL 2023, full season review from all the angles? Really hope you appreciate that. And then I'd be remiss if I didn't hear from Football Canada President Jim Mullin getting his thoughts on the XFL and the USFL. Jim says he has hot takes, opinions. Jim, Football Canada President, has been overseeing U Sports up north for many years. Wanted to get Jim's thoughts on kind of the XFL season as a whole, the USFL. And then obviously we're rolling into our CFL coverage now. Rookies are reporting, camps are underway. Very exciting times up there. We had Ben Grant on the podcast here a few weeks ago. So didn't want to forget about our CFL. And then longtime listeners, we have talked about McLeod Bethel-Thompson on this show for years. So glad we could get the Breakers to help set that up. We have talked with McLeod all the way back through the Spring League with the Blues up to the Argos. And we were in, Regina when they won the Grey Cup last year. I know McLeod got injured during the game, but just really excited to talk with McLeod, student of the game, journeyman, has seen it all. So really appreciate that. And then obviously Tré Watson with the Battlehawks. Really appreciate Brian and everybody over there for setting that up. Hope you guys enjoy the episode. Like I said, like and subscribe. You can still win your tickets to the USFL Championship game if you want that, or presumably the XFL 2024 Championship game, whichever one here we want, but try to get up to 3,500 subscribers. Hope you guys enjoy the episode. Pack a sandwich, should be a good one. Well, here we are. We made it. This is our big XFL 2023, postseason, everything here. What did we learn? Mike Mitchell, how are you doing?
I'm doing very well. Thanks, Reed, for having me on. It's going to be a fun conversation.
It's going to be good. I can hear you, which is half the battle today. We have a hard out here at the top of the hour. I have a groom that's in Beijing. So Mike and I, we sometimes we'll talk for like, I think we've done like 2 hours before, hour and 45. But
yeah, sometimes usually off the air, off the air.
So Mike, I don't want to waste a second, honestly, talking the XFL championship game. We have Cole Kublik's going to talk about that. We have Jonathan Himebauch going to talk about that. So I just want big picture, and then looking forward, we'll talk the XFL rookie draft, which came out today. That's exciting. A lot of impressions on that. I mean, really exciting stuff for that. If that's different than the USFL, I don't know, but we've made it. We're here, 1 to 10. What do you give the XFL?
7. I would give it a 7. I think overall, it's funny because when you sit down and think about it, you can find positives in the negatives and negatives in the positives, depending on how you look at it, whether you look at it from a football standpoint or a business standpoint. So, it's not enough to say, oh, we completed our season, so we did great. That's a low bar. Unfortunately, it's a low bar we've seen in this space before. Leagues run out of $50 bills. We've seen the AAF run out of funding and all that. So it's, the XFL 1.0 completed their season. XFL 2.0 would have. We know the story behind that. And so, yes, of course, tip of the cap to the XFL 3.0 for getting to the finish line. A lot of the financial decisions they made is so they can move on to a year two and a rookie draft and everything else that's coming, the fall draft and expanding of rosters to 90. So what they did in year one was to enable year two and three. So I totally get that. So, but I can't give it a 10 because there were certainly some missteps along the way. We know the home runs the league had, St. Louis, DC, those are earned. They inherited those home runs from 2020, and those turned out great. And then, we know some of the swing and the misses, like Vegas and everything else. So there's a lot. There's so many different layers. I know, like, in the world in general, people like white or black answers. And I understand I'm probably the king of going into the gray matter. So I'm always focusing on the gray areas of these things. But I think overall it's a positive. It's a fun league to watch and monitor.
I'm warming on this, and I've thought a lot about this last whatever. Just speaking of the rookie draft, I love that, and I posted my shorts today. Like, here we are, not 3 days out of, you know, 3-4 days out of the championship. You know, we have XFL offseason news, which I think is so important. And I was talking with, you know, Brian over in St. Louis when we were setting up the Tré Watson interview. Like, he goes, hey, we got stuff coming. You know, obviously we got to get done with the season here, take a breath. But I said that's so important because the USFL, the biggest, you know, one of the biggest complaints was, you know, July happened, then they disappear. And it's a challenge for these spring leagues to kind of keep that momentum going here after the season.
Yeah, you want normalcy. You want it to feel like a pro league, you know? And I think that's the fun part of like a year two now that we get into off-season mode. You can be like a Defenders fan, and let's see what happens with some of their players that they lose potentially to the NFL. But let's say the Defenders lose Abram Smith. You can go into a draft going, wow, we really need a running back. And because we lost Abram Smith, he's on the Rams or what team, whatever team he's on. So that's the cool part of it. So you hope the USFL didn't really hit on that the way they should have. And this rookie draft is interesting because you have a lot of players that, you know, they're a great player personnel people within the XFL, like Randy Mueller, Von Hutchins, all those great names. And they've been studying this draft class that just passed. They studied the last draft class. It's how, you know, a lot of the players that were in the XFL were from that. All the showcases and the scouting, all the Senior Bowls, everything, the combine that the XFL guys were at, Anthony Becht at the NFL combine. So it's going to be fascinating to see. Like, I'm sure they already have long lists of players that they liked in this class that either for whatever reason went undrafted and unsigned by NFL teams. So it's going to be interesting to see who these XFL teams target, who they pick up. We don't know yet the format, how many rounds it's going to be. We know we're going from 51 to 90 overall. But, you know, it's fascinating, you know, and these players are still going to have an opportunity to latch on to NFL teams. So, like, even if the Defenders, say, draft a running back that they like from this past draft class, that player could still end up getting a workout, tryout, landing on an NFL roster. We saw that last year happen with, like, guys like Steven Montez, De'Eriq King, you know, Farrad Gardner's, all those kind of guys. They got drafted and then they ended up going on NFL teams and then coming back to the XFL. So it's a fun process. And for the football nerd like me, I'm looking forward to it.
I'm laughing here. Max had sent me notes for our conversation. I pulled up. It's four pages here. So we'll do our best. We'll do our best. But I'm like, I totally forgot to pull it up. So I want a philosophical question for you. I've been thinking about this. You talk about the home runs that the league hit, right? Inherited, right? St. Louis, Seattle a little bit. If we go back now, if Dany Garcia just decides I'm starting my own league from scratch, and we'll call it, you know, the National Spring Football League, or we'll call it the, you know, the Rock Football League, or Dany, whatever we want to call it, if they're not carried down by the baggage that was these lofty XFL 2020 expectations, and I do think now in retrospect, you know, expectations were way off in terms of what they actually wanted to accomplish this year, right? Let's get through the season. Let's figure out what TV windows work best and all that kind of stuff. Are they better off just starting? We got 10,000 in Orlando. That feels good. We have San Antonio. Then we're not way down. I mean, did what we bring over from the XFL, was that too heavy, or did we do enough on our own to kind of balance that out?
It was definitely a higher expectation level because they were coming back as the XFL, no question about it. Because when you look at it, they did some very positive things. They were able to get a TV deal, maybe because of the XFL thing, maybe because of The Rock. They sold over 600,000 tickets, which is awesome. And I think they had a hard mark here trying to live up to the last league, which hit a home run social media wise, promotion wise, marketing wise. It wasn't perfect with 2020, but they did a lot of it was one of the best first year leagues, because that was a first year league, even though it was the XFL 2.0. That was a first year league. It was almost two decades separated. So I do think that this league, you know, they needed to tap into some of that 2020 stuff. Maybe there was an assumption that they're just going to inherit everything they got from 2020 and then just add Rock on top of it and boom, we're off to the races. But, you know, the fact that, you know, we saw The Rock in a GQ interview, and I think I may have mentioned this before, but we saw The Rock in a GQ interview said he wasn't aware of the beer snake. And, you know, That's part of the problem, right? Because like you're going into you're going into this league in 2023, you should know, you know, about the beer snake, have knowledge of it and about its impact. That led into greatness, you know, that craziness of week one where the Audi field security was stopping the beer snake, that led into lemons and that a whole new layer to the defenders. That was a complete, everything that took place in DC was a complete home run. They needed a little more awareness of the product. I don't know if there was enough awareness of what the things that made 2020 great. And I don't know if a lot of that stuff was applied for 2023. Different world, different landscape, no question about it, than they encountered 3 years ago. They didn't have two major networks pumping them out and promoting them. I don't think the league did a very good job. See, that's the thing is, like, I can look at the promotion and marketing as a negative locally and nationally, but part of that is why they're moving on to year two, because they save money on that end. But also it's why they didn't do as well as maybe they should have done in certain markets in terms of selling tickets and all that, recapturing things the way they did in Seattle a few years ago. So when you balance these things out, you can see the disadvantages and advantages they picked up from the last XFL.
Because I just, you know, and you get, and I appreciate the beer snake and all of that, and, you know, The Rock not knowing that. There's this fandom and everything, right? And I know The Rock deals with this with DC and Black Adam. I mean, you're going to have someone, okay, we're making the new Spider-Man movie, right? That I think that movie's, you know, the new one's coming out. And there's going to be someone, oh, back in comic book 87, you know, Spider-Man, and he had on green shoelaces that day. And then this thing. And so you're going to get that. Like, so you're encountering that kind of no matter what, right? And we're the spring football nerds. I'm curious, you know, you look at Taramani, you look at Zoa, you look at Black Adam, everything they've done. If you just have Danny and The Rock and they go, we're starting the league. Hindsight's always 2020, but not then you don't have any of these expectations. You don't have any of that. Well, the XFL in 2020 did 3 million viewers and you guys only did, and it's down. I just am curious about that, that if what they were able to build organically on their own was enough, or did we need the home runs of St. Louis and DC? And, you know, not really. I mean, what were the home runs? Seattle, DC, St. Louis, DC. I mean, I wouldn't even count Seattle really as a home run.
Yeah, it's, you know, the home runs, the quality of play, no question about it. The football.
You could have done that, but you could have
done
that.
Yeah, sure, absolutely. But, you know, it does take a lot of hard work to scout the right players. You know, they really got the football right, as far as I'm concerned.
But you know what I mean? That's something they did 100% on their own without anything. You know, I mean, that is something they did. No, I mean, you can't carry over any of that. I mean, they scouted. I mean, obviously.
Yeah. It helps, you know, it helps having people back too, right, who've been through the wars, like the Rush Giglios, the Doug Whaleys. That helped too to you know, have experience through the AAF and the XFL and have an understanding of the marketplace and where you need to target players, how you need to scout them, evaluate them. And then you have the Randy Muellers and those guys. So, you know, a lot of it, you know, a lot of what they did was you saw a lot of first year league issues like it's social media too, you know, unfortunately, you know, there's a lot of hardworking people, a lot of people that were like doing 2-3 jobs at once. So I don't want to be hard on a lot of people that are in social media teams, but I understand the difficulties of it, but I don't think the league did a very good job of promoting. Like, for example, we harp on this all the time, the football nerd in me, but this is just transparency, easy, doesn't cost a lot of money. Transactions, injury reports, should be on the daily. Practice reports should be on the daily. You shouldn't need Reed Johnson or Mike Mitchell or Anthony Miller or whomever, Evan Willsmore, Pat Rufano, whoever, to put out these injury reports every day. The teams should be on top of it every day because, yeah, you and I have somewhat of a following, but our following is peanuts. You know, to be honest with you, whatever it is, 8,000 followers, whatever we got, compared to what these leagues have, hundreds of thousands. So even the teams. So you need to every day. That's easy transparency, helps with fantasy, gambling, all that. I don't think that Redbird Capital capitalized on all the revenue streams they could have. I think that was a big factor. When we're following these leagues, we're like rooting for the business end. Like, I don't care about the NFL's business end. I know they make a boatload of money, hand over fist. I get that part of it. But when it comes to these leagues, we're rooting for them to survive and thrive. And so we focus on the ratings and the merchandise and all that. And I don't think Redbird Capital, which I had high expectations in them, you know, they did a very good job in terms of their fiscal responsibility, because here we are, we're going into year two and maybe year three, hopefully beyond that. But so I get their strategy with that, but I don't think they capitalize on the revenue streams in terms of merchandising, in terms of everything, gambling, all that. And I think some of these things are very simple. Like it took them forever to put transactions on their webpage. Transactions should have been each team's site. We shouldn't be looking towards, you know, some weird avenues, because only the diehard hardcores are following us and looking for our information. You want the mainstream public. I'm not trying to disrespect this, but I got to keep it real here. You want to get as much media coverage as you possibly can from the mainstream, because that's difficult. This XFL, what they didn't have is they didn't have the media coverage that they had prior, because they were limited because they got a competitor in the space that is going to try to limit them, you know, and that has two networks. And so you're not going to get the Fox and NBC affiliates to get all your players on and interview them and promote the league and all that. So it's amazing that Michael Strahan was on Good Morning America talking about how great the XFL was. You know, you got to recognize the real. But it's, so that was a hard part for the XFL. So in order for them to succeed, too, from a media aspect, they need to not only provide information that they should have on a daily basis in terms of the team's information leading into game week and everything else, but they also need to find a way, and this is easier said than done, than to get the media to cover the league. And they need to provide access and transparency to go beyond the Mike Mitchells and the Reed Johnsons and everyone else who covers these leagues. And really, that, because I wrote about this a few years ago, and Stephanie Rudnick, to her credit, did a tremendous job in XFL 2020 of getting the media on their side. I know they had the benefit of Fox and ABC at the same time, but you need to reach out and get the I hate to say it this way, but the standard regular sports media to cover the league beyond having The Rock on. We saw The Rock on First Take. We've seen last few days, Good Morning Football, talking about the XFL. That's awesome. But a lot of times when The Rock was on these shows, it was like very little was talked about in terms of the football itself or the teams or how they're going to stop Abram Smith or this, that, and the other. It was about Rock and, you know, his mantra about Player 54 and all that. But it's not about the team. So you'll know these leagues are a success when it's not forced, when it doesn't feel like a paid advertisement. And it's cool that they reached out. Pivot Podcast did a tremendous job. Ryan Clark and those guys, that was awesome. For anybody who caught that, that was really awesome. Interviewing Luis Perez and Greg Williams and Fred Keis, who, it was an awesome story this year, crying on that show. That was some awesome stuff if anybody goes back and watch it. So the XFL needs to provide information and be more transparent on their social media. They need to do that's free marketing and promotion. They needed to tap into better. They did a very bad job with the jerseys. That was something they touted, that we got new jerseys and new logos. They did a bad job with that. The price range, when they came out with it, you would have thought with Under Armour, they would have had a little bit of a stronger foothold and a better marketing strategy in terms of that. I think they missed opportunity in terms of making money and promoting locally in your markets by not having that merchandise available earlier on. So these are things that hopefully lessons learned from year one, and that this will decide whether or not we're here a year from now talking about year three, four, and beyond, is whether or not they can capitalize and learn from what I feel were missteps along the way. Probably one of the biggest ones was choosing Vegas, and now they, you know, I hate to put it this way, but they'll be stuck there most likely for year two.
Well, yeah, I just, to me, and again, I might be a little rosy just coming off of, you know, the championship game and kind of talking with all that. I think that there, and I would love to, you know, pick the brain of Russ or Dany, obviously, or anyone, like, you know, expectations of like embracement here, right? Of, you know, you've done all these other products and you know the response, like you said, that the traditional media gives you, right? And, you know, when Paul and I remember the first day we recorded our XFL podcast, and I'm like, well, here, I'm going to post it, like, bring on 10,000 views. Here we go. And you're like, oh, wow. Yeah, this really, I got to, you know, go on Facebook and post this. I got to go on Twitter and do this. I got to network with people and get to know these people and reach out. You realize then all the work that it takes to do that. And I'm curious now going into year two, if we will see more of that embracement. When Dany and The Rock did their little media thing on the sidelines before the game, and that was the last thing Dany said. She looked at all of us standing there. She said, thank you so much for covering this all season, putting in your time, putting in your resources. Because I'm curious if they thought, oh, we're going to serve this up and people are just going to eat it up. And then they're realizing, oh no, this is a grind that we got to go every week. And that's why you saw The Rock halfway through the season. I got to be retweeting these games. I got to be sitting here. Look at this defensive play. Look at all of that. Cause I think they realized, it wasn't just, you're not getting that free publicity all year, if that makes sense.
It's the truth. And a lot of what they got was by default, right? It was like in a positive way. Like if you look at it, they sold over 600,000 tickets. That's awesome. Their ratings, people don't want to talk about it. I know some reporters out there talking about
it. We'll get to ratings.
But these, all these different aspects, attendance, ratings, they were good considering like how hamstrung the league was in certain aspects, how limited it was in terms of promotion and marketing. They did really good. I know there's other spins out there, depending on who you're in bed with. We'll get into that. But that's really the case. So they did a good job, considering the bare bones aspects of certain things. I think they can do so much better than they did.
Yes, I do. And just to round out and, clip this for Reed the Homer, whatever. I think if you entirely remove 2020, and I know that's not, I know we don't live in a vacuum, and I understand you can't do that. But if you look at, MLFB and the AAF and, even like I was recording with Jim Mullin on here, and I don't understand why USFL gets this, like, we're the underdog mentality when you're owned by the largest, and literally all they have to do is go, hey, all you broadcast crews and everyone that you do all this stuff all year for a living, we're going to do that for another 3 months in the spring. Right. And it's really not that big of a leap where you have, and I know there was people from 2020 that returned, you have this smorgasbord of 800 whatever employees, plus all the players and everything. We've never done this before. We're trying to do this. And I think if you remove 2020, I really do think it was a home run. I know the Vegas thing, and we've talked that to death, but having 800 whatever people that have never done anything involved, and have never all run a football league together, it's like a band. You could have a tremendous guitarist and the drummer, but like you bring them together, you got to kind of get through the working pains. I don't know.
I agree.
Way more positive coming out of this weekend.
Absolutely. And that's why, like I said, I can find negatives in the positives, because that's what I tend to do. That's just
what I do. I make views off of that.
And I tend to find positives in the negatives. We could talk about the local promotion, lack thereof, or whatever. But I also see how doing that, there's a strategy behind it, so we can get to rookie drafts and fall drafts and year twos and year threes and all that. And their hub is a very state-of-the-art, top of the line. It's like it's really good for the players raved about the way they were treated in this league, and so much so that when it came down to vote for a union, they didn't necessarily say we need help here, we're good. So I mean, that's another topic for another time. But when you look at the whole picture, it's like you asked me 1 to 10. I think I threw out a 7 there. I do think this was they scored, they hit, and I feel like they missed out on some things that could have really made it a complete home run as far as I'm concerned. But as far as the product goes, I enjoyed the product. I think it was fun to watch. And I think the biggest thing, it may be small to people, but I think at the championship game, which you were at, Reed, many other people were at, the diehards, it was so cool seeing all the different fans from different fan bases, teams be at the game. Obviously it goes without saying Brahmas fans or Renegades Defenders fans who showed up, but then like the Battlehawks fans, and you even see some Guardians fans. I mean, that was really cool. That to me is a win. And that was one of the aspects I really liked about the league, is the crowd energy, even in the so-called smaller crowds. I even give the Vegas crowd credit. They very easily could have had 55 people at the games, 111, like we saw at a certain Stars game recently. So, I mean, so even them having 6,000 fans at the game, and there was decent, and all things considered, considering how late they were to markets, how things were held up ticket wise, I thought the league did a very good job. And I think having all those fans show up at the championship game was like a positive sign for not only what this season meant, but for the future as well.
Yeah, you got to turn it into a traveling event. It's got to be like the Grey Cup. It doesn't matter what team you are, you're going to come. I will say, if anybody in the world is listening to this involved in the XFL, if you're going to do the bye week and kill any momentum you have at all coming out of the playoff game, I understand we got to get people got to travel, we got team rest. You got to embrace the media more with that. Having the media day announced on Friday, 2 days or whatever it was, the day before, 2 days before, I reached out every single team except obviously Arlington and DC that were in the title game. I said, give me people for the show. We're going to be there. We're doing this. People can call in. All they got to do, you know, Vipers got back to me. And then Orlando, who's phenomenal writer, you know, Andy with Orlando. But I'm like, what is the point of having the media bye week if we're not going to do anything media until Friday? Just if anyone's listening, the bye week's fine. Do it earlier in the season. But if you're going to do it before the title game, because don't you think, Mike, what do you think about that? And we'll segue into TV ratings for the championship game. But I think if they would have done it the week after the playoffs, I do think it could not have hurt the championship ratings.
I agree with you completely. I don't want to like go on too long. I'll just echo your statement there. I'll say this. It's not a bad thing to copy what other pro sports leagues do, you know? So like, I know some people want these leagues to be different, but when it comes to like media day and all that, all you got to do is like, just what does the NFL do with this? What does the NHL do with this? What does the NBA, what have you? So I think that would have been useful to use that strategy of like, you know, not doing it like last second kind of thing. You know, it's like you can really build up momentum for the product if you handle it the right way.
I would have sat because Fran was on the show, you know, with Our Sports Central. Fran was at media day. I was talking with Fran. I would have sat there all day Friday and done it. I would have done an 8-hour stream. Let's bring in people. This is going on. Like, you know, not that XFL gives a care or whatever, but like I would have been happy to do it for free to sit there and talk with everyone to do all that. TV ratings, you know, championship game. We kind of did this. We did, you know, we started at 1.3. We ended at 1.4. How, you know, the anemic TV championship ratings. What did you make of the XFL championship ratings?
Yeah, they're right about what I expected, right? So, like, I know a lot of industry experts out there. Shout out to Sports Media Watch. You know, they're direct and fair when it comes to breaking down all these ratings. They don't have an agenda. So they predicted 1.35 million viewers for the XFL championship game. Ended up being 1.436. I mean, you could say maybe, you know, they could have done a little bit higher. But perhaps the Dallas Stars game, which did with your Kraken. I don't even want to bring them up, but it did 2 million viewers on ESPN at the same time. Maybe, I'm not saying that's had a huge effect, but I'm sure that drew in some Texas people to that game rather than Arlington's game on a championship night there. So they could have done a little bit higher. I know internally the expectation wasn't like 3, 4, 5, 2, or even 2 million. I know that for a fact. So the network itself was pleased with the overall number, because it could have been a little higher. Sure, it might have been if the Kraken had swept the Stars and got them out of the way. But it is what it is. Sorry,
well, that's a non-zero factor. I mean, I was arguing with I think it was one of the guys that helps moderate the Facebook group with me, and he's like, "Well, that didn't affect." I'm like, Arlington, like it was the Dallas team was playing hockey that night. Like, you can't.
It was a huge game. Just at that Texas market, that, you know, the Dallas Fort Worth area, that definitely, you know, I'm not saying that Arlington is the Renegades are such a huge draw that they have all of Dallas interested in them, but it definitely would have been a 1.5 million or maybe a 1.55 million. It would have had more viewers than 1.436. I know the championship game peaked at 1.8 million viewers. When you look at it during the season, that was kind of like, you know, you knew that the championship game would do a higher rating, and you know, than the recent games that took place. It was a prime time game. You know, they had 6 games overall during the season that averaged over 1 million viewers. They averaged 1.13 million viewers on ABC. No surprise that 5 of the 6 games were on ABC that were over 1 million viewers. They need more games on network television. They did really well on ESPN2 and FX. They were the number 2 ranked show on both those networks. They did extremely well in the 18 to 49 demo. It was the most desirable thing. They did well with ad revenue. I know some people are trying to lump in different ad revenue aspects to try to, you know, try to create an apples to apples comparison. It's not really real. But I think overall the ratings were good for the XFL. I think they could have done so much better through scheduling. Being on ABC more would have helped. We had some games during the early season were pretty funny. A lot experimental 3 a.m. finishes, 2 a.m. finishes. So they tried to build up FX, which, you know, they got a great show there, Snowfall, but you know, they don't have much else on that network. And then, you know, the fact that they were number 2 on ESPN2 and FX shows you that these are respectable numbers. And I think they did very well on ABC. They could have done even better than they did. The championship game was right at where I thought it would be. Could it have done a little bit higher? Yeah, I think so. But I anybody who is like, you know, painting a picture that it should have done 2, 3, 4 million viewers is just not really paying attention to the to anything that's going on. You know, that's basically that, you know.
You, we've all better thank the prayers that the Sea Dragons were not in the championship game, because I'll tell you, if Kraken Stars are up against Sea Dragons, Renegades, that would have been a problem. In terms of the TV schedule, and it, just so we can talk about a little bit on here, you know, USFL this year ratings have been, you know, kind of scattershot. We've had some really good stuff. What kills me about these XFL USFL ratings debates is it'll be like XFL on FX at 7 o'clock, whatever, and then you know, primetime NBC for the USFL. They're like, oh man, it killed it. This, it's like, yeah, like I yeah, like what?
Yeah, you know, what do you expect? You know, there was one we had only certain instances where it was apples to apples comparison. Yeah. By the way, like network versus network, cable versus cable. The XFL, we saw that in week 10. Versus week 2 of the USFL, I believe the XFL won out in those direct, for real, apples-to-apples comparison. An ESPN2 game that does 285,000 viewers within San Antonio Brahmas can't compete with an NBC primetime game or Fox that does 600,000-700,000. I know this is more about the XFL now. The USFL, smart strategy with the lead-ins. They've had only one game so far that's gone over 1 million viewers. So maybe that'll change in the next week. Of course, the Kentucky Derby lead-in game that did over 2 million viewers. It's a brilliant strategy, because these leagues have, and this pertains to the XFL, Reed, they have what we've seen from this ratings example or ratings war, whatever you want to call it. We've seen a splintering of the audience, yes, but we've also seen that these leagues right now have a limit, like a cap, really, on their viewership, unless they get a very strong lead in or a lot of different factors that play into their favor, with like maybe playoff series being over, nothing else available to watch. Maybe they get some extra casual viewers in the mix there. Right now, there's a cap, 1.5 million, 1.4 million. There's kind of a cap there. So, and I think we've seen that these leagues are trying to figure out, how can we grow our audience? How can we get, they need more media coverage. You know, and so having more media coverage will help. They need to draw in casual fans. And then hopefully this off season, XFL players signing on to NFL teams, that kind of thing, that'll help maybe lure in more people for year two. Like, hey, let me give this league a shot. That's the same strategy with the USFL as well. Them returning for year two. And they're hoping that people will be more, open-minded. Because a lot of regular people, to put it that way, are dismissive of these leagues. So they don't think they count, they matter.
Well, I think you can, and I use YouTube and the show a lot that's how I gauge interest, and not that like my whatever, but I think you can get a sample if you look across at different things. And, you know, I added X number of viewers, you know, kind of in that, well, a couple week lead up to the XFL kickoff, and then probably not nearly as many then right during this, you know, that you kind of hit there is a cap. There's a cap to the number of people that are going to watch that. I think that, you know, Dany, I hopefully now, you know, is understanding that, right? Of, you know, how are we going to, you know, I remember when she purchased the league and talking about, you know, we want this to be a women's league and appeal to that, because she said, I grew up watching football and there was nothing about it that resonated with me. So I'm hoping that now that we've gotten, again, past this growing pains of year one, like, let's experiment with that. But my question is, you know, we've talked before the 120,000 earmarked, right, for budgeting. You talk about billboards. I've seen no billboards ever in Seattle. I know that there was, you know, I guess one in San Antonio or whatever. Do we suddenly now like open the floodgates for year two? Or is this like you get $250,000 now to go market?
I don't know if floodgates are going to be open. Like, the league made money. They got the $150 million rights deal, which is good. They made money on ticket sales. They have good sponsors. We saw Budweiser and other top end sponsors during the XFL championship game. So there is some revenue streams they've created. I don't know, spending versus, you know, I think it would be beneficial for them. And it's good to see this, that the teams are actually still doing some local stuff. We saw that with Seattle Sea Dragons and all that. I think that's baby steps, that you do more and more of that. Now that the, you know, it took them a while to get to even to the point Vegas held up the entire league in terms of ticket sales and all that. So it's, you know, now that they have all this time, I think they can do a so much better job of connecting locally. There's talk of mini camps. We've heard that. That will help. The more they can do in these local markets, the better. They don't necessarily have to break the bank, so to speak, but there needs to be more focus on putting their resources and time into those areas because they can do so much better than they did. They did a lot of what they did by default.
We're seeing a lot of the players sign now. It seemed like there was kind of the spike, right? Day one, I think it was 11, and then it was 5, and then, you know, 3, whatever. Interesting, you know, and it was pointed out by you that, you know, there's a finite number of spots on NFL rosters, right? Pending cuts, injuries, all that. I'm curious what this logjam means when the USFL goes to do it, because of course this XFL is going to be compared to last year's USFL in terms of players being signed, even though, again, that's not comparable because there was no XFL. You know, there's still US, you know, all backlogged a lot. But are we pleased with the number of, you know, because I think overly so, the broadcast this year talked about, we got to get players to the NFL. This is what they want to do. I don't think we needed quite as much of that. Max has a note here about that. Are we pleased with that number? Was it worth, you know, the talking all year about it for 20 players, whatever, so far?
Yeah, I think these leagues, the XFL, there's no doubt that there's a lot of talent within the league. There's hundreds of players that have recent NFL experience that I definitely think are worthy of being on NFL teams and having a shot. So, but the thing is with any of this is the numbers game. I'm a football nerd, so I have a full list to the right of me here of the NFL roster size for each individual team in the league. And most NFL teams, I believe it's 14 right now, are at 90 already. And so there are only 21 openings. So even if all those 21 openings are for the XFL players, that's across 32 teams, those 21 openings, you're still only going to be capped out at 40. Now, this situation is fluid because there's injuries. There's a bunch of different things that happened, June mini camps, and then a training camp's not until July. So there'll be players added on during that period. But I think this first wave is, you know, this first wave of 21 players, I believe it is, that's where we're at the moment. And so could it grow? I saw The Rock tweet out 60 players. Maybe that's wishful thinking. I don't know. We'll see, though. There, like I said, there is 21 openings right now. So I would figure, you know, we'll see more DC players get signed and more Renegades players and other players that are going to get opportunities, you know, and these are very fluid. It's funny what happens when we start getting into June and July and all that. Yeah. But I think this first wave is what we're seeing for the league. There are guys holding out, like the AJ McCarrons, that are going to be very selective where they go. And so, and there are some other players that are considering that. Like the Niners really like Jakor Pearson, but they have 90 players right now. So in order for, this is funny how this works, in order for like a Jakor Pearson to get on the Niners roster, he's worked out for 3 different NFL teams, he's going to need the Niners to cut somebody. Somebody's got to lose their job. And then it's funny watching this situation. It's funny watching this situation because I see players that are cut that I go, wow, that got to be great for the CFL or the USFL or the XFL. And watch Jacob Eason and Preston Williams today were cut by the Carolina Panthers. I'm looking at those two players thinking how great they would be for the spring leagues. But so in order for these guys to get jobs, and that, there's cool situations too. Like I wrote about, like Hakeem Butler is going to be in practice playing against Kenny Robinson. So you got a 2020 Battlehawk against a 2023 Battlehawk in Pittsburgh Steelers camp. And we might see a situation where USFL players play with XFL players during the summer, during preseason games, trying to make NFL teams. So that's very cool. But it's about opportunities. The numbers game is not fair. There's definitely a lot of players within the XFL that are deserving, no doubt in my mind, of a shot in the NFL. You just have to find an opening.
Someone definitely told The Rock that 50 USFL players got signed to rosters last year. And he's like,
yeah. And it was over 70. It was over 70. I think eventually, because during this, what happens during the NFL season too, is obviously injuries. So there's going to be XFL guys that get into the NFL during the season that try out for teams that have a great tryout, and they'll get on a team in September, October, or they'll get on a practice squad. That's going to happen. Like Josh Johnson didn't join the NFL in 2020 until later on in the season. Taylor Heinicke didn't join the NFL until later on in the season. So he wasn't a guy who was like just signed and made his way on. There were other guys like that, Austin Walter, Isaiah Williams, et cetera, et cetera. So the process, it's fluid. So it's going to run throughout the fall. in terms of players getting on. But you're not going to have 60, 70 guys sign on to NFL teams if there's only 20 more spots open.
Just not,
The math doesn't work out. There has to be openings in order for players to get onto teams. So, but I think we'll see a good, healthy amount of guys getting opportunities. And then the key at the end of the day, like right now, there are 14 XFL 2020 players that are still on NFL rosters. And it's not just like random guys. These are guys who are going on to season number four in the NFL, which is like such an awesome success story. You know, the Donald Parham's, Taylor Heineke, watch him take over for Ritter in Atlanta. PJ Walker's backing up Fields there in Chicago. So these guys have made it through. And so I think that's a big key, how many of these XFL 23 guys end up on the 53-man, on the practice squad, end up making an impact. And the league has done a good job thus far, and they need to stay on top of this, of celebrating the fact that their players have signed with NFL teams. They need to, during the summer, retweet and post videos of if Ben DiNucci, hopefully he's not throwing a pick six and infuriating Sean Payton, but if he's throwing a touchdown pass in camp or what have you, maybe he's throwing one at Jakobb Pearson. Who knows? That would be funny. But you want that stuff to be hyped up, because you want to be proud of that. You also hopefully that continues on, because it's a huge selling point, not only for fans who are on the fence about these leagues, but also players who might consider playing in the XFL in the future.
All right, we got about 10 minutes here, so we're going to go rapid fire. We got a lot of notes here. I just, you know, kind of general reactions to this. Are we going to be XFL 2023 on Twitter forever? Are we going to reach out to Xavier F. Lepage to invite that? Like, in terms of the – this is one of that, not even the most important things, but, like, what do you think about that?
I would reach out to Mr. – I don't even know how you pronounce his name, Lepage. I would reach out to Xavier Lepage, and I would see if we could make a deal to get that XFL handle, because you can't just every year, like you said, go to 2024, 2025. There needs to be a handle for the XFL that's a permanent one where they're not changing it all the time. So, why not reach out to him? I wonder if he gets tagged so much. Even, you know, you got guests on the show like Coach Jaime, who tagged him recently. You know, he gets tagged so much because he has XFL moniker there. And so hopefully they, you know, I would reach out to him and make a little sweet deal, send him something his way and whatever he wants and move on from there, because it'd be great to have a steady handle.
Speaking of Jaime, and I heard rumors about this, and it was Jaime talked about it in his interview coming up. Renegades very disgruntled that they were not featured very prominently on Player 54, right? That was honestly part of, like, this is came from, I was surprised. I kind of heard rumors about that. So, like, did Player 54, was that a success? Like, what do we want to see from that? They kind of aired it inconsistently. It didn't feature all the teams adequately. Like, it's hard. We want the best story. Like, you're trying to manage that. How would you do Player 54? Again, these are rapid fire.
I think the show needs to be weekly. I think they do need to focus more on different teams. And I'm not surprised by that Renegades thing, by the way, because when you get behind the curtain and you talk to players, like I was talking to players on the New Jersey Generals a little while ago. And so you find out certain things. And so Renegades use for motivation, the fact that they were disrespected, the fact that they were ignored, the fact that they were opposing teams, coaches saying that they shouldn't have been in the playoffs. That was bulletin board material for them. And players, that's all players and coaches need, is that little extra juice to get you going. And they definitely used it. And I think they could have done the XFL. Player 54 was great. I think they could have done a better job with it. I think it needs to be weekly. In a perfect world, it would air before games.
Yes.
You know, 100%. That's just a perfect lead in. You know, let people teach people about the players in the league, and then, hey, check out the game now. So I think it's cool.
Yeah. What was the XFL content house? Did we ever use that? That was supposed to, remember, we were going to be Dallas, the pinnacle of everything. We were going to have everything right out in Arlington, the content house. Just, you know,
I don't think it was capitalized. Yeah, I don't think you're right. I don't think that was capitalized upon. That was something that was brought up about, like, doing that content. And I think there were some teases of it during the season at the hub itself. But I don't think that was capitalized upon, for sure.
Max has a comment here, and I've said this before, you know, sometimes lack of understanding, it seems, and we've talked about the beer site thing, but XFL management, understanding what makes a spring football fan tick, right? And we're hammered down, you know, getting to the NFL and all of that. We're a lot of fans, and Max, you know, Max says here, we just want to sit, watch football, enjoy it. We want to have our stars. It's, you know, the NXT WWE thing. How do we build stars, but also, like, you still need to watch our show every week? How do you think they did this year? And with thoughts on kind of management, ownership, as it relates to that?
I think they did a decent job with that. I definitely think they could have done a better job. I think that lies within their social media teams. I think that's content that they should have been putting out there in terms of like the TJ Barnes. What an amazing story. Anthony Miller did a very nice article about him. That's one of the great things that were about the league is these players that not only are starting and advancing their careers, but also came back to like write their own narrative. And then, you know, TJ Barnes goes out a champion. So I think the league could have promoted their players during the games. You saw some of that during Player 54. You saw some of that, but I think it could have been done a little bit more on social, posting clips, highlights, little comments from the players, little things like that. These things add up. So I think they didn't really take advantage of, like, I guess if you want to say building stars or getting people to know these players better. Because you see during the season, I pay attention a lot. It's funny. Like, I tend to ignore the hardcores in this space because and I pay attention to what the casual fan says, even though they know nothing about the league. So you tend to see, oh, my God, I didn't know Josh Gordon was playing the league. Oh, my God, I didn't know this guy was in the league. What? Really? When did he join the league? So it's like I'm paying attention to that. So I think like you can create more awareness was a big problem. It's always a big problem with these leagues. It's a big hurdle. And you need to create awareness of your players and your product and do a better job of that. So I think they need to work on that for the future.
I think and they originally the plan was to have two social people for each team. I think one local and then one in, you know, and I thought like that's overkill, whatever. Like I get that now. And I think that obviously that's the plan, but you know, trying to have it like Haley works her ass off during the games, you know, and Jay's working and you know, Leah's working, but you can't have one person and we got the Wi-Fi issues at the arena. Okay. We can't post. We're trying to get on. I know that you've talked about, you know, the lack of kind of, we've talked about this lack of in-game, you know, the XFL accounts tweeting all that. I think you got to have some people at home base doing that and then some people and then.
Yeah. And you can't over, I just want to say this quickly. You can't overkill it with content. So I don't expect them to put like a 20-minute press conference, but like a little quick highlight of Bob Stoops on there, like maybe snapping at Anthony Miller, you know, during a press conference that would, you know, like that little stuff, like what would be cool. A little post game thing, a tease. You can put that little video and then here's the link for the YouTube deal. So, I mean, and they did a very good job. As in terms of highlights and everything on YouTube, but unfortunately got lost in the shuffle. People didn't notice it. Like, really? Rod Woodson said that? Yeah, like 3 weeks ago. Jim Hazlitt said that? Yeah, like 4 weeks ago. You know, so it's so I think they could have done a better job with that. Just a quick little, they had some really cool stuff and content, but they got lost in the shuffle that they didn't even hype up. Well, sometimes they didn't hype up their own games. You know, they get the wrong network. They're not during game day, not, you know, posting highlights and staying current with what's going on. It's laughable a little bit, you know, but it's not everybody's fault. But I mean, you can't have a championship game go on, put no highlights on there an hour after the game ends. All of a sudden you put a little photo that's, you know, shows the final score of the game. You have to do a better job than that.
Last thing here, we'll get out. Offseason preview, rookie draft, they announced today, you know, we posted all that going to be streamed on June 16th, I think is what it was. What do we know about that and how does that relate to the presumed supplemental draft happening in the fall?
Well, they're definitely not. We've seen like a lot of players get activated off the reserve list. So they're definitely not maxing out to 51 and 90 in a rookie draft. There's not going to be like 40 rounds, you know, but, you know,
lost in that. Yeah. Cause the rosters are being, yeah, they're going from 50, 51 to 90, man.
That's a big one. That's a big one for me. So then there's a lot of like areas there that you can question whether or not, oh, are they going to take 90 players to training camp? That's a little bit down the road to figure that all that whole thing out, but we don't know that for sure. But this isn't going to be like a 30 or 40 round rookie draft that gets you to 90 players immediately. So they can go, they can sign guys, they can do all this kind of stuff. But I think the second draft, the second portion of this, I think this is great. Like this rookie draft is not in because they're going to be in contact with agents, players that were unsigned, players that they've scouted, that they've already had contact with. So this is not like a just drafting players for namesake that we own the rights to the individual player. These are actual players that they want in the league for next year that they want in camp getting opportunities. So I think a lot of these players are going to be legitimately joining the teams because they, you know, right now they're not under contract with any pro football league. They're not in the NFL. They might get opportunities during the NFL season. So I think these two phases are fascinating. Adding rookies that these personnel departments love and that they loved in the draft class and they feel were overlooked and ignored. And then when they add the next layer, which could be rookies again, by the way, all undrafted guys that don't make NFL teams in September and a lot of veteran guys and all that. So there's two phases to this. And I think this is just like the beginning because, you know, it's every year with the XFL, the big part of their rosters, the most interesting part of it is going to be those guys that are on the fringe that just missed the cut. The guys are on practice squads like we saw in 2023 that ended up going to the XFL. So that's what we know so far. The question is whether or not they're going to bring 90 to training camp. I don't know that yet. They maybe if they have mini camp, they'll do that and then do cuts after mini camp before they get to. And there's also other layers about the Alumni Academy and everything else, but that's stuff we can talk about in the future. That's unknown at the moment.
Yeah, Alumni Academy seems to be kind of on the hiatus. Yeah, because the thing is, you know, they're not being paid to be there on the roster during the summer. So it feels a little like the USFL, like, oh, we signed this guy 2 months later, or tweet, you know, okay, we cut this guy. Like,
agreed. You know. It was kind of it's a little bit of a longer delay because what they had in November, they drafted these guys, but these guys weren't under contract. They didn't start getting paid until they got into camp. So for 2 months there, Abram Smith, Josh Gordon, all these guys were, you know, Seattle Dragon
under contract, but not.
Yeah. But, you know, but they weren't officially in the league yet. They weren't like, you know, paid, you know, they could have left for the NFL or what have you. So there's a lot of like stuff behind the scenes that we need to figure out in terms of all that. But there's going to be an NFL out for these players until week 16. Same thing they had in November of last year after they had their draft and extended into December, January, what have you. So, these players want to be drafted. They're going to be scouted. Their agents are going to reach out to their league. There's a lot of players today that are so excited from this news that they're, you know, they're going to have an opportunity. The intention is to have these rookies in camp and be a part of these teams. If they get an NFL opportunity, cool. They're going to sign letters of intent to be a part of the XFL. It's just a question of whether or not the NFL shows up and gives a young kid a shot in a tryout or what have you, so, which could happen.
So if I'm on the XFL roster right now, I'm on a 2-year contract. I'm on a 1-year contract.
Yeah, there's some ambiguity with this whole situation right now because contracts, if you're in an XFL contract, your contract expires on 12/31.
But do they have the option then to
bring it? So now there is a mutual option. I don't know the language. In the past, I've gotten my hands on the contract. Yeah. I'm working on it, people. But they did mention to me, through my article I wrote today, and it was mentioned to me through the league, through sources within the league, that it's a mutual option between the players, the teams, and the league. So I don't know exactly the specifics of how that works out, but these teams are going to retain the rights to these players. So I would assume that a lot of these young guys, like we'll see what happens with Harrison Frost and all that, but let's say Seattle's coaching staff is back with June Jones. They liked Harrison Frost, so I'm sure they'd love to, you know, bring him on back for year two, keep developing and maybe give him a shot more. Hopefully the league has, they got screwed over by the ice storm, but hopefully the league has maybe a preseason game or two or an exhibition game or two before the season starts, you know, to give guys more playing time and opportunities to make rosters. So it's fun stuff. All this football stuff is fun.
Last notes here. We'll get out of here. I texted my brightest. I'm running 3 minutes late. Overall thoughts, what do you make of this XFL 2023 in review, kind of post, you know, post whatever, putting it to bed today?
It was very good. It was fun. I'm anxious about the next chapter. You know, if it was a disaster, I wouldn't be interested in the next steps. So I think the league can showed a lot of promise and can be better in year two. And it's fun. It's interesting that the XFL is going to actually have an offseason. They never had one before. You know, because of various circumstances, you know, so this is an interesting time. You know, everybody's winning. Football players, coaches, people in this profession are winning that these leagues exist. And hopefully it continues on. You got to give credit to these entities for actually putting their money and resources into these leagues and trying to make it work. Hopefully they do.
Yeah, the biggest thing, like we've talked about, you know, off-season content, keep it going. I know that's hard. You got all these signees. But, you know, like the Dragons, you said they're already doing stuff. Like, I want to see more of that. You got to keep this existing 12 months out of the year. It's really hard. And the USFL, I think I would give an F for that last year in terms of keeping anything going. Any other notes? If they called you Mike Mitchell, they said, what do you want us to do here in the off-season? What's your number one marching order?
My number one marching order is to promote and connect better. You know, that's what they need to do. They need to connect better. It's hard when you don't have games going on, you know, so it's very hard, but you need to connect better locally. You need to promote better. You need to find avenues. It's hard too when you have, you know, a little bit of a media issue with certain outlets not wanting to cover your league. So it makes it a little bit, there's some hurdles there. So, but you have to work around them. And then, you know, they need to take the lessons from year one and, you know, take constructive criticism, because there were people in this space like you and I and others that were you know, voiced our opinions about Vegas and other things that they were doing. They went ahead and did it anyway. So you need to pay attention, market research. You need to pay attention to people who have knowledge about these leagues. So, and you need to apply it. You can, they can do, they did a good overall. It was a good league. It was fun. It was fun to watch, fun to monitor. They can do so much better. Hopefully they apply the lessons they've learned. So that's basically what I'd say. Apply the lessons you've learned. You know, it's unfortunate. The Vegas thing to me is an L, and it's probably going to be an L in year two as well. I hate to harp on the negative, but even if they draw 10,000 fans there, that market is a problem to me, is problematic to me, because I don't think they embraced fans showed up, but I don't think the market itself, media members, yeah, you know, leaving games and while they're going on and bragging and laughing about it. That's not the place you want to be. You want to be in places like St. Louis and DC where they absolutely embrace and love the league. And anybody who's been in a Defenders game or a Battlehawks fan will tell you it's like one of their greatest sports experiences ever.
Well, I've heard that. Yeah,
I've heard people talk about that. Casual people that, like politicians and just regular casual people that went to Defenders games and said, wow. So like the people should really want to come to see these games. And so you want to be in markets like that. And so we'll see how it goes. Learn from your lessons of year one. You can be in an even better and stronger league if you apply what you've learned.
Yeah, I am a wedding videographer by trade. We've shot, produced, edited over 450 weddings in my life. I still talk with brides and grooms every day that think that they know exactly how to plan the wedding and you don't know anything. And that's fine. It's, you know, it's your right. And I want you to have the best and happiest day in the world. Doesn't mean I'm not going to voice an opinion sometimes. Same with the XFL here. You might have all the money and resources, USFL, all this stuff. Mike's been around the block more times than I have. I've been kind of around the block. You got all, you know, Mark and everyone. I mean, we've all, it's okay to take some ideas here. It doesn't signify failure if you're like, oh wow, that was actually like, we didn't think about that, or oh wow, the beer steak, that is something that
yeah, it's like funny to me. All it took was 5 minutes, like, you know, to talk to somebody who lived 2020 about the beer snake. I could have told you that you don't understand, like this atmosphere is so amazing, what these fans do, how great they are. I know some people think that they ended up hating the beer snake, but it really is a cool thing that the fans do there. It's like the unity that's involved, yep, there, the energy, atmosphere. So the fact that they didn't know that was a thing tells you why they had some issues.
Yep. All right, Mike, Godspeed. Thanks for your time today. And well, I'm sure we'll be talking here as soon as I get off here. I'm sure we'll keep talking.
Thanks. Thanks, brother. Your show keeps getting better and better. You've done a tremendous job covering these leagues. I know the USFL people love you, those crazy USFL fans. They love you to death.
Love it.
Continue to have USFL guests on and talk about the USFL and cover it and retweet it and all that. Let the crazies say whatever they want to say.
All right. Thanks, Mike.
No problem, Reed. Thank you.
Well, when this gentleman isn't frequenting, I guess, Detroit Field now to watch USFL games, which is probably a conversation for another time, we have Bill Shea here with The Athletic, had his kind of end of the season recap with the XFL, talking TV ratings and everything else. Bill, how are you doing?
Good. I'm good. Thanks for having me.
I'm good. So Bill was on kind of mid-season, and we were cracking the magic formula, I think, for spring football. I think I was very proud of the episode title we came up with that week. We're back here now. We have some figures and everything else. You know, $1.4 million for the championship game. It kind of did the U during the season. What did you make now that, you know, 10 weeks plus playoffs, championships done with the XFL?
That's a great question, and I'm still sort of digesting it in my head, because this is the first time we've ever had two of these spring football leagues at the same time. And I am not a regular. I'm not sitting down every weekend now and watching eight different spring pro football games. Some people are, and that's awesome. But I do have a soft spot for these things. I played minor league football many years ago. So I do take an interest in these things. And honestly, You know, I'm probably not the best person to analyze the quality of play on the field start to finish for both of these. I think they're very similar. And I think it's much like the original United States Football League in the 80s, where you had some elite talent, you know, clearly a different property, different value proposition back then, what they were trying to do. But you didn't have much depth on those teams after the stars. I've had a number of conversations with Bobby Hebert, who was the Michigan Panthers quarterback in the 80s. And he talked about that Panthers team in 83 that won the championship would have been like a mid-level NFL team. And he's very insistent they would have beaten the Detroit Lions head-to-head, and he's probably right. But they lack depth. And that was a problem across the league. And at this lower level of the modern USFL and XFL, that's true too. There are guys in the games that I saw that will clearly be playing on Sundays in the fall in the future. There is the talent there. And the NFL and scouting is much more sophisticated today than it was 30-some years ago. I thought the talent was fine for what the products are for both leagues. The production quality of the networks, I thought, fine. And that's one of the things that really interests me, because these leagues have their various rule quirks and things like that. And I think much like the original USFL, which people forgot, had a lot of the things the NFL later adopted. Coaching challenges, replay, all that stuff was there. The two-point conversion. I think with these modern minor leagues, the NFL, and yeah, I know for a fact they're looking at these broadcasts, just like, and they'll talk heavily with the broadcasters. I really liked the live look at replays in the booth, and then broadcasting that inside the stadium. Now, some people may argue, oh, hey, like you lose the drama of what's the ref going to say after this 7-hour replay and Talmudic debate over, you know, is the toe in or is the toe out? Having it live in the stadium, and the people when I was at a Panthers game a couple weeks ago were surprised by that. They didn't know that was coming, that on the video boards, hey, there's Mike Piera, and they're talking about all this stuff. I liked that a lot. And I'm guessing the players may, coaches may as well. I like that level of transparency. I'm guessing some version of that ends up in the NFL one day. You know, then there's all the kickoff and other challenge rules and all of that. It'll get sliced and diced. But I like that these leagues can serve as a live lab for that sort of thing. Because we've all had these ideas, I think, at different points. Oh, the NFL should do this, that, and the other thing. Well, here it is playing out. And some of it works. You know, the leagues are still different in the, you know, XFL in all of its home markets. USFL is in 4 cities now. I imagine they'll move to 8 at some point. We may see expansion. We may see some of the other old USFL IP from the 80s turn up in new teams. I think that would be cool. But I don't know how much differentiation there is with these leagues beyond, you know, playing in home markets, and that may change as the USFL does that. Is there enough to differentiate for fans and advertisers to have rival leagues? It could happen. You know, in the 1960s, we saw the American Football League and the National Football League competing for a lot of things, and help that rivalry helped birth the Sports Broadcasting Act and the antitrust exemption for the NFL that's so important, that sort of thing. And those leagues obviously had years of talks about merging, and they did it, and we got the Super Bowl and the modern NFL. I don't know if the XFL and the USFL are positioned to do such a thing. There's lots of talk about, oh, they could merge. Well, these are business rivals in many ways as well, network rivals.
Well, it's also fundamentally, and you had in your article, I mean, fundamentally different how they're viewing it, where you said Fox is viewing this as cheaper than alternative content that they're using to fill. Do you sense the XFL, and I don't want to be the homer here, that they have a different view of what they want their league to be?
But yeah, you know, it's outside ownership, because Fox owns the USFL with NBC as a partner. They have perhaps different goals. You know, it's a springtime lineup filler, and it's a fun one, I think. Whereas the XFL with Dwayne Johnson and you know, his business partners, Redbird, and you know, his ex-wife, you know, nobody wants to lose money on that particular, on that end. Fox has a little bit more leeway and financial leverage to play around and absorb some things. You know, but they also do have, you know, goals that align. They want to be seen. They want to sell advertising and corporate sponsorships. The fundamental business goals are the same for them. You know, they both clearly want to develop talent that goes to the next level, to the NFL. You hang your hat on that. You know, and particularly for boomers and Gen Xers like me, we remember Herschel Walker and Jim Kelly and those guys, Steve Young, Hebert, Anthony Carter, going from the USFL to the NFL. Different circumstances, obviously, then, because the original USFL, they spent themselves to death, even with decent TV contracts at the time and all of the drama that happened there. These leagues aren't trying to do that. And they're all single business entities, too. There are no franchisees. There's no owners to compete. I talked to Al Taubman, who had owned the original Panthers, obviously, before he died. And, you know, he was extremely wealthy. He lost millions of dollars, but he told me it was worth it because he had so much fun. They won a championship.
Well, yeah, but you can't. That's quite the expensive championship.
Exactly. Different era. He was a guy that could afford to do that. I don't think anyone is interested in spending themselves crazy to a title in these leagues. It's not the same thing. They're not competing, you know, with the NFL. That's a immediate. A fatal mistake to do. Everybody's learned from that. We're still trying to learn if there is room in the springtime for professional football on television that doesn't lose a ton of money. And I think because we're in the streaming era, this is a great time to try that. With all the flux, why not? And, you know, as someone that loves alternative football, I love that we have two leagues duking it out. And they're not exactly the same thing. And that's interesting. Besides the rule differences and the uniforms and the names and the scheduling, you know, they have different, you know, one's owned by a network, one's owned privately. Although, from what I know, Fox very much like someone to buy it or buy into it to offset some of the production costs and all that. But, you know, I think one or both will be around for some time, you know, and particularly if they can produce some guys that go on to NFL success. You know, you get your Jim Kelly you didn't know about or your Reggie White that emerges from these leagues. That's a huge thing to hang your hat on. Who's the, you know, and legal betting helps too. And, you know, and I really suspect if we get to the point, and this has to happen at the federal level, if they legalize cannabis, you know, for a while there, it was CDB or whatever everybody was buying into, you know, it's like booze. It's a enormous marketing windfall for whenever that happens. And that will help prop things up. You'll see such advertising in leagues like this before you'll see in the NFL or baseball. You know, this is a place to test stuff. So that's down the road.
That would be exciting. So I want to talk, and I've gotten to the point now of homerisms where now even if I share anti-XFL stuff, I get criticized. I shared your article on Twitter here, you know, XFL title game, TV viewership sluggish, ESPN says season met expectations. What did you make, you know, like I said at the top, kind of we did a U during the season. I don't know if that's a good or bad thing to end. You know, you don't want to end with less than you started, but to end with, you know, relatively about the same. What did you make of the 1.4 in comparison to the XFL TV ratings?
I thought, honestly, it would be a bit higher. You know, the television landscape has changed even since, 2020 when they did this the first time around. And with heavy promotion and, you know, the outside discussion, podcasts, you know, there's an ecosystem that has grown up around these leagues now that wasn't available 40 years ago to help out. I honestly thought it would be a little higher. If it had hit 2 million, would I have been shocked? No, I would not have been. But honestly, with all the promotion and stuff and discussion, and I thought it was a little sluggish. The U was absolutely expected. You know, you have your your curiosity factors when these leagues start. And that's almost always true. There's been a handful of leagues that were a bummer from the beginning, but I couldn't even name them. They're so obscure at this point. But you know, you start off huge. There is some churn as you lose viewers and you level out to whatever you think that's going to be. And then you know, fingers crossed, get a big number at the end for your playoffs and championship. Because of the structure of the XFL season starting a week after the Super Bowl, all of a sudden you're dealing with, you know, the Masters and March Madness and things like that. The bottom of your U may be a little deeper. And, you know, everybody knew that going in. You know, if the USFL turns in a similar number at the end for their championship game, I think it would be an even bigger bummer, so to speak. Look at the Panthers Maulers game right after the Kentucky Derby. You know, huge lead in. You know, it was 15 million people or whatever watched that. So, you know, you have the people like me who just sort of lean back on the couch after the horse wins and there's 20 minutes of post, you know, interviewing the horse or whatever. And then you go into the USFL game and people stuck around. They got 2 million for what was otherwise a really nondescript game.
And not necessarily a great game either.
No, I'm sure the network would have loved, you know, like a 41-39 shootout thriller with crazy rules coming in. But that would have been great. But they still got 2 million. I mean, that's one of the best audiences of the season. And you would hope their championship game comes in around the same. And obviously the mixture of what you're putting on broadcast TV versus what you're putting on cable plays a major role in that as well. And I think we've talked about this before. What benefits sports properties like this is organic discovery. That's harder to do in the streaming era because you don't have that ability to just easily flip through the cable guide and like, oh, that if you're going in and out of Amazon Prime and Netflix and Hulu and all of that, you don't stumble onto stuff as easily. But, you know, this era will change for all of that stuff down the road. But I'm a little bit more interested in how the USFL does with its championship game, because simply it's had bigger numbers this season than the XFL did. And part of that, again, it's a product of more network television. And I think starting mid-April, you know, they got themselves on the other side of March Madness, you know, and it's not just the men's tournament, the women's tournament obviously has grown as well. And that's always going to be a bigger overall sports property for the networks. But, you know, Fox has promoted the USFL hard. I live in a USFL market in Detroit. There's billboards all over the place. There's heavy social media pushes, more than I have seen from the XFL. And part of that's because I'm not in an XFL market. But it's a lot, you know, as much as I see as for a Lions season, you know, right now they're pushing all of the tickets because the schedule is out. So there's tons of that. But that USFL championship game, I think, will be illuminative for how this season, you know, it's season two for them, how that has played out. And, you know, what did they do right? What did they do wrong? So I'm really curious to see that number and which teams are participating. Because the XFL had a 4-6 team. You know, Bob Stoops' team was in there, and I think a lot of St. Louis fans were upset, rightfully so, about that. But that's where you run into the structure. You only have 8 teams. Everybody's not making the playoffs, so this is the sort of risk that you run with the structure. Is you're going to get good teams that have to miss the postseason, unfortunately. But if they're doing well enough where they expand, that becomes less of a problem. But, you know, it happens occasionally in the NFL too. You know, there was a Browns season in 07. I think they went 10-6, missed the playoffs. You know, so that's a bummer at any level if you're a fan.
To be fair, I live in the XFL Seattle market. I have not seen any billboards here, so it's not just because you're not in an XFL. I had some facts here, and like I said, check out Bill's article on The Athletic. talking in-game, because this is, you know, we talk attendance and we've done that to death, but the, you know, in-game TV advertising estimates show the XFL lagging behind the USFL. Your Cantor Media via TV Insights, they show that the XFL completed the regular season, generated $20.6 million in ad spending. With 3 weeks of the USFL for 2023, they're on pace to do $41.3 million with $12 million, you know, already done. Thoughts on those figures and thoughts, because we want context now that we know that they, we have these figures.
Yeah, and keep in mind, these are estimates. These, you know, these are the pros, so they have some insights and access to stuff.
But it's more than people arguing on Twitter or message boards. So that's what I like.
I wasn't real surprised by those numbers, simply because the USFL is a network-owned property. They have the heft and the leverage to get more money out of this than a rights deal like the XFL, with the Disney properties. I think if it's your thing, you can do more with it. You can bundle and do stuff. Disney advertising can do that as well. But you know, it's a bigger company with a lot of priorities going on. That didn't surprise me to see those estimates at all. I thought that was kind of in line. You know, USFL, I think, has more games on broadcast television where you're simply going to pay more, and there's just more options to bundle that's in the network's advantage versus the rival network also wants, you know, the XFL to do well, but it has many other priorities. These leagues rely on TV, obviously, quite a bit, and the revenue generated by that to fuel ratings and such. But they're a bit like minor league baseball. Sort of a weird hybrid comparison here is that they also rely a lot on game day revenue and whatever deals they may have structured in their home markets for, you know, ticket sales, parking, merchandise, all of that. And because they're single entity structures, it's not, you know, the Seattle Sea Dragons keeping all their money and not having to share with the Vegas Viper or whatever it may be. It's the league handles all of that centrally. So that there's a bit more flexibility and less pressure there. But that's, attendance matters way more at this level than it does at the NFL. I mean, you could stage an NFL season with zero fans and those teams will still be fairly profitable because of the enormity of their national television rights deals. They just dwarf everything else on television, and we'll just keep getting bigger and bigger.
I always laugh because the USFL, they like, attendance doesn't matter. You know, it's just a TV project. But then, like you said, you see all these billboards. Hey, we've got the mascots, bring your kids, and we got face painting. And I see more ads, obviously, watching the USL games. You know, come to our games. But yet I hear, well, attendance doesn't really matter. I mean, obviously, it must matter to them either from an aesthetics perspective or making money, because, you know, they're spending the money to run ads to get people to come out to the stadiums, at least.
Yeah, I that's absolutely right. It does matter. It's to what degree? Well, until I see their books, until they share their financials with me, which is never going to happen, unfortunately. We don't know. We're trying to make educated guesses. But yeah, aesthetics is a big part of it. We have learned since the pandemic, people prefer to see sporting events with fans in attendance. It feels weird to watch something without. You know, we all remember the bubbles for the NBA and WNBA. In limited attendance and things, it just plays better on television. It's not that these leagues were ever going to get full. You know, the game I went to a few weeks ago, it's Ford Field. They had like 15,000 people, which was fairly solid for the lower bowl. And I thought a nice crowd for what that property is. I don't know what they're paying Ford Field to be in there. Years ago, it was 2008 or so, there was a proposed football league, and I forget the name of it, but the recession killed them because the league was financed by student loan debt. One of the giant lenders, private lenders. The whole thing was predicated on the money from that. And then the recession hit and everybody defaulted on things. And but they had $1 million deal with Ford Field and couldn't pay. And there was some lawsuits and things. And the Lions who run the facility got a bit skeptical of getting in bed with things like that. But, you know, in the case of the USFL, it's Fox. It's a business partner of the NFL. I'm sure there was protections in there, but you know, these facilities are not cheap to rent because it's not just, oh, here's a check, we'll come in. I mean, there's a ton of stuff they have to pay for, you know, security and concessions and, you know, what's your concession deal on merchandise, you know, who's handling that. You know, the game I went to, they'd shut it down as soon as the game ended. Like there was people who wanted to buy jerseys and I was going to buy a USFL, just the blue t-shirt that says USFL, just to bum around in the weekends. And I was like, oh, I'll just get it after the game. Whoops. Well, I couldn't. So they were going to make sure that didn't happen again. But yeah, I mean, there's like big expenses behind the scenes as well. And these leagues and their partners are looking for any sort of revenue to offset that, because this stuff's, I mean, even with the controlled salaries and the, you know, the labor costs are relatively low. Well, it's not nothing. You know, and these, and I'm getting these emails for discounted Michigan Panthers season tickets now, like $25 for the rest of the year. Like, you know, part of that tells me they want bodies in the stands who will buy things. You know, they get their per caps and all that. But they want fuller crowds. And the game day was fun at Ford Field. You know, I've been there a million times covering the Lions and other events, but I thought it did just fine.
It was funny. Whoever wrote, whoever wrote the USFL article, this was like the Fox. This was the USFL article for that. I think they had the attendance at like, I share it. It was like 6,500 or something. Like someone shared, because like, hey, Reed, like, because Fox, right? We don't put out attendance numbers. And my God, that was trauma. They ended up going back. I think they updated the website because they're like, we can't. I think it was more than 65,000, but certainly not a sellout. The other thing here, before I get you out of here, you have the playoff figures here for the XFL this year. They estimated 1.3 million in ad revenue for the two semifinal games. The NBC Fox postseasons last year got 6.7. And then you put, I think for context, you're a 1 30-second ad for last Super Bowl average, 7 million. So one, you know, 1 30-second ad for the Super Bowl is more than the entire USFL. Yeah, but that's to be expected. What did you make of that? The 1.3 million for the playoffs. So we heard reports that not all the inventory was sold, that XFL was giving it away. I know USFL had kind of bundled stuff last year. We were talking off camera before we started.
Yeah, I think that kind of mirrored the trends we've seen with the regular season with these estimates. It's partially a function of you know, Fox having much deeper investor control here because it's their property and their ability. You know, last year they had the Super Bowl on Fox, so they had a lot of leverage in the things they could package and like, okay, you wanted the game, well, you know, the dominoes fall on how these deals are structured. And I'm the first one I could be off base here. It just feels like the USFL is just promoted, better promoted, more vastly broader promoted by Fox and NBC than the XFL is by Disney and ESPN and ABC. It's not like they're not. But I just think, you know, and the USFL, it didn't have competition last year and in the space that it exists. And it fell into a good time to do such things. Whether they get that sort of money this year, I don't know. We'll find out after the season, but they both paced kind of where I thought they would be with advertising regular season and the playoffs. Now, if the USFL gets some enormous number somehow for the championship game, we could see an uptick going into next season. But it's definitely fascinating to look at.
Well, it's, you know, the USFL last year, and it's so hard because everyone, we want to compare it. You know, XFL 2020 was really its own thing. USFL in 2022 hit in a way that I haven't seen anything hit and hasn't hit since. XFL this year hasn't, USFL hasn't, where it was just enough time from, because people with the XFL and, okay, my heart's ripped out. We were in the middle of all this. And then now we've waited. You know, I mean, the USFL, the YouTube streams for the USFL draft did like 30, 40, 50,000 views on just the USFL podcast, just them talking about the players being drafted, right? So there was a hunger for that. I don't know if that comes back this year or not. It certainly hasn't hit with the XFL the same way. And the USFL has been down, as we've talked before, I mean, year over year, than last year as well.
Yeah, no, it's interesting because, you know, in a relatively short amount of time, 2020, 3 years ago, seems like a million years ago, pre-pandemic. 2019 feels like it's mythical at this point to me. But I, the XFL, I think in some minds, had a little bit of an anchor to it, because through no fault of its own, it ended midway through 2020 because of the pandemic, and then went into bankruptcy and this little ugliness around that with lawsuits and the Oliver Luck and McMahon and all of the baggage around Vince McMahon as well. And for folks a little bit older, remember the first one became a national joke in 2001. You know, the late Hunter Thompson was making fun of it on ESPN2 way back then. Like, why does this? And it was such an over-the-top ridiculous. It was just, you know, WWE and NFL trying to mix those. I understood where they were coming from, but it just did not work. Other than it's $70 million fail and Rod Smart, he hate me, what does anybody remember? I don't even remember the team names at this point. I don't think that helped, whereas the USFL has become, that IP from the 80s became, it's recognizable to two fairly large generations, boomers and Gen Xers. And there's sort of a almost mystical nostalgia around it because of what it produced. And then the Donald Trump and move into the fall and the lawsuit, and there was the 30 for 30. There was a little bit more history there, and it was a very smart move, I think, to use that IP. And I think it helped give a leg up to the USFL 2.0, because I tend to use the 2.0, 3.0, just because we're talking about two different leagues, and there's like been five iterations of these things, and all the other leagues that have existed around it. You know, and ultimately it comes down to how much of a public appetite is for this, and can that appetite be monetized in a way to make it sustainable? I think it can be. I don't know if it will be for two leagues. Maybe they do merge, or maybe we do get a minor league Super Bowl. I think that would be insane and awesome. The XFL champion versus the USFL champion. I don't entirely rule that out one day. Even though these networks compete, they also work with each other on a lot of things too. That, you know, Fox and NBC share NASCAR. You know, there's a lot of crossover between rival networks, and on the sports side especially, there's a lot of talent that has gone back and forth, production guys and stuff like that. So that's sort of my fantasy, is to see that minor league Super Bowl and see what kind of, you know, what will it happen? Probably not. Would it be awesome? Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, imagine seeing The Rock out there and, you know, all the USFL people and some of their old alumni and just to decide, this was the first year Fox and NBC could use the old USFL, yeah, like the footage and stuff. They finally got the rights free and clear. And we started seeing the players come back. You know, I had talked to Hebert 3 years ago, and he was so excited, yeah, about doing this. And 2 weeks ago was the first time he's been back for, you know, he finally got, I mean, obviously the Panthers didn't play here in Michigan last year. But, you know, they had done stuff in state prior to this season, and he was super happy to be back. He's, you know, the Panthers were a big part of, you know, they launched his career and they got him off welfare back in 83. So, you know, all of that sort of stuff, I think, has served the USFL maybe a little bit better than the XFL. But it's fun having both of them while we do, and the debate between which one is better or worse and which one will last is fun.
I don't think that there was a more joyful time I had on the podcast than it would have been that summer, or I guess it was the winter before leading into the spring of the USFL, tracking all the lawsuits and the IP, and we were tracking. We had like IP lawyers on the show. It was a whole thing. We rode through that, you know, USFL suing itself. So Bill Shea with The Athletic, I really appreciate it, your insights, and was happy to see a new article come out about that. So thank you for always appreciate the insights and context for everything.
Yeah, thanks for having me, and be on the lookout, because I'll do the same thing after the USFL title game and anytime there's major news out of these leagues, and hopefully it's positive.
Hopefully. Thanks so much.
Thanks for having me.
Well, I saw this man working hard. I was on the field and then up in the press box, and then we were at the trophy ceremony. Saw you running around, and we have Cole Kublik back here. How are you doing, sir?
I'm doing great. Doing well. Kind of bummed that the season's over, but it was a fun ride for sure.
Yeah, Kraken ended last night. XFL, I don't know what to do with my time anymore. What did you make first off of the game? I mean, obviously Arlington coming back, exciting. I don't hear as many complaints now about the playoffs now that Arlington came back and dominated. But what did you make of it all?
Especially when you think that I mean, if we were to go 2-4 best teams in the XFL, Arlington knocked off two of those in the playoffs to be able to get that championship. So credit to Bob Stoops and his staff. I think the first thing that stuck out to me sort of after the game is we hear this term, and I asked Luis Perez about this after the game. We hear fit so many times. Oh, that guy's a good fit for this. That coach is a great fit there. I think they found a quarterback that was a great fit for what they wanted to do, and he understood – timing, rhythm, when to get the ball out. He understood spacing. And when I went back and watched that first game between these two teams, DC was giving up a lot of space, and Luis Perez was able to find it. Now, the question is, are you going to be able to protect long enough for him to be able to find that space? And they did. He was able to sort of dink and dunk, got a little bit going on the ground game, and they got turnovers. Turnovers were really the difference in this game. And I think they did a great job. And that Arlington defense did a great job in some of the sight adjustments and where they knew Jordan Tiamu was going to be reading the RPOs, and they stayed in those lanes. And yeah, you just get a finger on the ball, but it showed you that can give you a couple interceptions, and an interception that's essentially taking away a touchdown because it looks like DC was going in. Outside of a couple of big plays, I mean, you had the big run and you had a couple of big Tiamu runs, and you had the one big pass. I mean, if it's not for that, Seth, that game's a blowout in favor of Arlington. So I was surprised just because I thought DC was the most consistent team the majority of the year, and they were balanced. I mean, Abe Smith, most productive running back in the XFL, not even close, by the way. That offensive line, even though they suffered some injuries early, had been fantastic, and the defense had just been a problem across the board. But I can tell you, being on that DC sidelines, there was a lot of frustration. It looked like a little bit of the leadership disappeared. And Arlington showed up, man. They came to play. Give them a lot of credit.
Well, and I know that a lot of the season obviously focused on A.J. McCarron and Ben DiNucci. You know, he had some of these bigger names. But from a human interest story, I think Luis Perez here, and just to think of the journey he's been on in the last 5-6 years, and, you know, having The Rock hand him the MVP trophy, you know, after winning, and confetti, and Dany Garcia is there. I mean, truly just kind of an incredible moment, I thought.
Well, and you know, I kind of asked him, like, how we talk about that fit, like, how are you able to fit in with this team and this group? And he just said, there's a lot of great guys here. There's a lot of great guys on this team. I talked to Bob Stoops before the game and asked him just kind of how it's been, like a recap sort of. And he just said, we've had no problems. We've had no issues with any of our players. Everything has been fantastic. And I know a couple of those guys on that team personally, and they've talked about how much fun it's been, even though they had some ups and downs as far as losses early in the season. And then, yeah, Luis Perez, a guy that walked on, learned how to play quarterback watching YouTube, you know, transfers, has a lot of production in lower-level college football, you know, Birmingham Iron, XFL last time around. Like, the kid's been all over. He's like spring football Hall of Famer. And, you know, he goes out and wins the MVP. It's pretty cool to see. Like, he's the most unassuming, successful quarterback you would see. Like, when you see him walking around, like, his demeanor, his physique, you don't say, wow, I want that dude on my team. That's just not who he is. But then you see the pictures of him at Thanksgiving making his aunts and uncles and grandparents line up so he can run plays and do different things. Like, and that coaching staff told us, like Coach Hayes said, he's the best preparer I've ever had at any level. So it means a lot to him. And I think it's pretty cool to see him be able to close it out, because he's kind of started his journey in a lot of different places, and now he finally got to finish it. And maybe the wildest part about all of it is, if he doesn't throw those pick sixes against Arlington week one, Arlington's probably not in. So that gave them a win that got them into the postseason. So just a crazy year altogether. But Luis is an amazing story.
Yeah, when I saw that they posted the halftime, him in the locker room screaming, you know, we got one half and we're world champions. I said, oh, Renegades by a million here. I mean, you really just felt like they had that energy. And I just think you get to that point where I'm going to will my team, you know, down the field. And Luis felt like he was at that point.
He was in complete control of that game. Now, you also give Davion Smith and Letty Brown, when Davion was a little bit nicked up and Letty Brown comes in, they were fantastic. And there's a guy inside of this league right now that almost nobody's talking about that needs a little bit of love. And Luis Perez was fantastic. But one of the reasons he was fantastic was that offensive line for Arlington. And Jonathan Himebauch, their offensive line coach, this guy won a championship in the XFL as a player. Now he's got a championship in the XFL as a coach. And he was a champion in the USFL last year with the Birmingham Stallions. So he probably needs to be coaching at a higher level of football just because he's that good. And I know people in the offensive line community think the same way. But to see him be able to get it done too, and that group sort of come together, they had some younger guys that hadn't played a ton of professional football, and they got them going. And that run game, they needed that run game late to make sure DC couldn't get back into that game. And especially the last two drives, they were able to hammer that thing down. So Luis was in control. He knew exactly where to deliver the football. And then when that run game got going, I mean, it was lights out O'Reilly.
Yeah, no, Jonathan, friend of the show, he was on preseason. We're going to actually have him on this very episode. So he's a long time.
And I didn't know that, by the way.
No, I know. That's good. No, but just I know what you mean, because and he's come with such high regard, and what he's done, and, you know, all levels of football is tremendous. In terms of the championship game itself, the pageantry of it, the trophies, right? We had Dany and The Rock there. Like, what did you make of just the whole spectacle?
It was fantastic. It kind of, and I'll tell you, it kind of started. I've done, I think this was my fifth trip to San Antonio this year. I did the Alamo Bowl too, so I've been there like six times this year. You know, when we roll up, we usually just go right to our truck and go in. We had to go through an extra thing around for security, and you know, you saw the different, you know, symbols and whatnot, and they did a great job decorating the stadium. It felt like a big game. Just the atmosphere just felt big. That lower bowl was about 80% full, over 22,000 people there. And I thought the coolest part about that, Seth, was I saw Houston fans. I saw St. Louis fans. I saw Seattle fans. Like, I saw, obviously, San Antonio fans, the game being in San Antonio. But it was pretty cool to see almost the entire league represented with their fans there for this championship game. Maybe some thought their team was going to be in it, but either way, like the one Battlehawk guy, the famous dude that's like, show that he's like, man, I got to grow the league. I was like, you keep working, bro. Like, I love it. It's amazing. But that crowd had energy. It was loud. It was a very cool, very fun environment. It felt big from pregame, like you mentioned, postgame with Dany and DJ. It was awesome. And the game was super physical. I mean, there were some big hits. Unfortunately, we had the situation with the cameraman. I'm glad to hear that he's doing okay, but that stalled things for about 15 minutes. But it was an exceptional scene there in San Antonio.
In terms of, yeah, we said it kind of needs to be like the Grey Cup is in the CFL, where you kind of go to the Grey Cup no matter what team, you know, if your team's in it, if your team's not. I think the XFL benefits from that. You know, I think they would have done it in Dallas if I think the stadium could have accommodated it. But it was good. The Alamo, we didn't have to worry. We thought there was going to be thunderstorms, and then it ended up being – I mean, it was just kind of an awesome day.
And, you know, you saw DC fans. They tried to get the beer snake going. They traveled that thing over from some local pub and had it in the bucket sitting right there on the sideline. So it just, man, I tell you, it was a cool environment. I wasn't really sure what to expect. You know, we knew that there are a certain amount of tickets that had been sold, but you didn't know that other fans were going to show up in their gear for teams that weren't competing. You didn't know they were going to be loud. You didn't know they were going to get into it. And Even though the game felt like it was a little out of hand, DC did have opportunities late to get back in it, especially with the 4th and 15. So we had a little drama too late, which sort of ramped it up some.
In terms of, we've already had signings announced. I mean, we're recording this a little bit earlier in the week, but 11 players so far. Danucci, now obviously the DC and Arlington teams, you know, they can talk with, you know, do all that kind of stuff now after the championship. What do you make of that? So many players getting, you know, already getting looks, getting shots for the NFL.
It's not really surprising. And, you know, there's a couple that haven't really been signed, haven't been announced, that I'm surprised we haven't really seen them. I think there may be another, like, I think, and obviously even guys that aren't signed are going to be in camps. Like, I wouldn't be surprised to see Te'amu in a camp and be able to stick around for a while. Jonte Kirkland out of Houston, the wide receiver, that if he doesn't get banged up this year, I mean, he's going to be somebody. We already saw Pearson is running by guys in camp as well. In the NFL camp, like, he's all over the place, Shakur Pearson. So he's doing some good things. There are a lot of guys in this league that can play, especially at the skill positions and especially up front on defense. Whether it was St. Louis, Houston, like, multiple guys. T.J. Barnes for Arlington, I think he's got to be in a camp somewhere. Like, the dude was disruptive all year. I know he didn't have – it's one of those old adages in football that some people don't really get. Like, he didn't have 20 tackles for loss, but, like, he affected plays each and every week, and he's just a monster. So I'm not going to be surprised a lot of these guys not only get into camp, get signed, but end up sticking around. Like, you know, to see Romo, kicker for San Antonio, be able to get in, it's a cool story. But it's – there are going to be multiple guys that don't just get into camp to get signed that actually make these NFL teams.
What coaching staff impressed you the most this year? I mean, Renegades coming back, DC kind of dominating the whole time. Somebody else, what were you most impressed by?
I know they didn't get the championship, but I probably still have to say DC, just because you have a two quarterback system that actually worked. You had the best rushing offense in the league, but you didn't do it through the formations that some other teams tried to do it through. And that was, you know, two tight ends, pro set, pro personnel, like, we're going to run right at you. I think that group probably went in, and Coach Kice is just amazing. Like, just being able to be around him and hear his story. I didn't know anything about him before this season, and now I just love talking to him. But the usage of tight ends that they had, you know, big play receivers that they had everything on offense. And then defensively, yeah, they're a little high risk, and that probably cost them in that championship game. But you get a guy in Greg Williams that knows the league very well. He got his guys to play at a high level. Like, their safeties come flying downhill. Defensive line, disruptive. So I would probably have to go with that group. But, like, I'll say this. No one's going to put San Antonio in there because of where they finished. But they played four quarterbacks. They had five different offensive linemen that were injured at some point in time this season. I think they played, like, nine different offensive linemen this year. They lost their starting tailback this year. They lost their safety, the bell cow of their defense this year. For Hines Ward to still have a chance to get into the playoffs late in the year after all those injuries that they went through, and keep in mind, he made a switch at offensive coordinator after a couple weeks. He sent his coordinators to the booth after 2 weeks. He did some things from a coaching perspective that kept them in it. And I know the record is not where everybody else's is, but you overcome those injuries and you make those big changes in the middle of a season – you got to give the guy a little bit of credit for where he had his team at.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, even when they did the trade for Luis Perez, Arlington did, I'm sitting there and I'm like, okay, well, this is good for Luis, but I don't see this really affecting anything or making a difference. I mean, I think even when they, you know, when they sent out the press release, and then, you know, it shows that the people were competitive all year, right? The staffs were competitive and they never gave up and they always wanted to be in it, right?
Well, and then two, just dedication to what you do, like understanding that execution is still the most important part of football. And I think, you know, you look at those two brothers that are running the offense and the defense for Arlington with Bob Stoops, and we just mentioned their offensive line coach, who's one of the best in the business. You got Scott Spurrier handling your special teams. Like, they've got other great coaches on that staff. And, you know, I'll throw out Houston too. Like, everybody knows Wade Phillips, but nobody knew A.J. Smith going into this year. You know, nobody knew Pardee handling those receivers and special teams. And so it's just – I think there are a lot of guys from a coaching perspective that put themselves on the map this year in the XFL. And like what Anthony Beck did with St. Louis, like A.J. McCarron was a great get, but when you looked at that roster at the beginning of the season, you kind of said, okay, like I watched this running back play at Wyoming. I love the way he runs the ball. I don't know about the offensive line. The defensive line doesn't look super athletic. Do they have the perimeter guys to really contend? And they may have had the second best team in the league in the regular season. So I give Anthony Beck's group a ton of credit. Like I you know, he and Hines Ward, I think, proved to a lot of people we deserve a look as far as being a head coach. You know, you got a guy sitting there in DC that nobody's talking about. And now people should be looking at him saying, could this be an NFL head coach? Could this be a Division I college head coach? So I think it's just, we talk about all these opportunities for the players and signings and free agents and camps. But there's going to be some big opportunities that comes to some of these coaches out of this league as well.
Well, yeah, we just shared Good Morning Football. I had just done a little segment on that, talking with Scott Pioli about how, you know, not only are the NFL teams scouting, you know, players, but obviously coaching and staff as well. That there's, you think that all facets of the league players and staff are going to get looks.
I don't think there's any doubt. And I think that if you go by certain position groups and how they operated, coordinators, and that's where the access really helped them out. And you had guys like AJ that bought into it and said, come on, like, let's, I want to be a part of this. Like, I want people to know who I am. I want people to know what I'm doing. You know, June Jones, we all knew what he did, but we got to know his personality a little bit more, like how he calls plays, the communication process with the players. I understand that that's going to get cut off in the NFL, and you won't even have that in college. But I do think one of the big takeaways could be, whether it's college head coaches, NFL GMs, NFL head coaches, they got to listen to how they communicate with their players. And that's big, because that's how I was sort of drawn into AJ. I'm like, listen to what this guy's telling his players. It wasn't just that he called good plays. He was communicating everything with them and letting them know, this is why you need, hey, slide in 3 yards. You need to be here because I want to get outside leverage on that corner. When coaches see those kind of things, those little details, they love that. And that was an opportunity for the coordinators to really put themselves on a map and really make a name for themselves, as well as a lot of the players.
Yeah, we had Matt Barry on previewing kind of this the championship weekend, and he thought, and then they already had an article out where ESPN's looking at, you know, trying to, how can we incorporate more of this, and with the rules and the transparency that, you know, the XFL innovated with the sky came back a million years ago here, and now we've had other things, and wouldn't be surprised to see some of these things transfer over.
No, and I mean, listen, I've said it for a long time. I don't know how the kickoff rule is not at every level. I really don't. It's just, honestly, I think it's dumb that it's not, because we want to have kickoff. Like, nobody wants to say, oh, what time are they putting the ball down in Auburn for the game Saturday? Like, and you start on the 20, like some people want. Like, nobody wants. We want kickoffs. We want the game to kick off. We want the spectacle that that is. We know that's how we start our games. But to remove 90% of those violent collisions, yet still give you the opportunity for big plays. I know we only saw one kick return for touchdown this year, but to not sit there 99% of the time and say, it's just going to be out of the back of the end zone. Like, who cares, you know? So now you've got big play opportunities, and we actually get kickoffs that matter. How many games did we see? Hell, this game, we saw two kicks that worked against DC and that were massive advantages for, I mean, they started in like the 35 going in one time off a damn kickoff. So that made that play so much more important in this league than it is in the NFL or in college football, because it's just not. It's out of the end zone 95% of the time. I don't know how that's not there. I really would take a look, if I were a different level of football, at being able to review one thing across the course of the game. I loved it. Now, we also love it because of who we have and Dean Blandino up there talking us through it. And I realized that if you're doing Conference USA or Mountain West or even SEC games, like, you can't have that for every game. So that's a big part of it. But just to be able to do that and to be able to go back and look at one thing across the course of the game, it can change the game. And I saw it change the game a couple of times this year. So I think some leagues' eyes are going to be open to different things. And then obviously, too, like you said, just the way that certain things were handled from a broadcast perspective, we already saw Brett Yormark in the Big 12. I guarantee you this had something to do with that. Him saying, we are going to look at miking up players. We're going to look at coaches' interviews, not just at halftime, maybe at the end of quarters or in game. Like, we had Gus Malzahn on our show here in Birmingham, and he's like, that's going to be a part of it. We need to market our teams. Like, I'm all for it. Let's go. So the leagues that aren't the Big Ten and the SEC and really the NFL, they've got to start doing things to put themselves on the map, to separate themselves a little bit. That's one of the things that the XFL had figured out from the beginning.
Well, I like how, you know, and we were talking with the rule when Becht had the rule, you know, the challenging the holding or whatever and all that. It felt like I was kind of watching Survivor or something, where players are learning the strategy of the game, right, and kind of figuring it out.
Yeah.
And we've seen that with AJ Smith, like you said before, with the, you know, the comms and all that. So I'm excited to see next year here how some of these coaches, like, okay, what can we learn from this? Because I do think this first season, it's like, okay, what the hell's going on? Like, let me just kind of get through this. But, you know, the smarter coordinators and coaches and staff kind of figuring that out, I think, is going to prove dividends.
Listen, there was a lot of gamesmanship as the season went on for different guys. I heard a lot of conversations about things they were trying to figure out, strategies they were trying to use. I thought one of the coolest things, and I know that the people at home didn't get to see a lot of this, for me, were, and Anthony was one, Hines Ward was one, the conversations that they would have about when and when to not use that challenge flag. I mean, it was awesome because that you could tell I saw guys, they wanted to do it. And then either somebody else or they were trying to, we would hear them in the headsets. What do you think? Did you see it? What do you think? Did you see it? They wanted to use it, but they just weren't sure enough. And I asked Hines a couple of times, like, how have you decided what the strategy is? He's like, man, I'm just trying to learn on the go. He's like, I'm trying to get as much communication as I can from upstairs, other players, what they saw. What does the replay look like? Because the replays were different in different stadiums, how you got them. So it's there's just, like you said, there's going to be so much more next year that guys already know how to manage that's going to take them to the next thing to be concerned about, try to worry about, and try to be better at. It's going to be really cool to watch.
Finally here, before we go, just kind of XFL in retrospective, what did you make here of the season now that it's all said and done?
I thought it was awesome. Listen, I'm never going to pretend like the access part is not the coolest part for me because I'm on the sideline doing it. And I thought the coolest part, too, is, like, those guys started coming up to me. And that's when you know they get it. And, like, one of our best hits that we had was that playoff game in D.C., and all of a sudden somebody grabs my arm. I'm like, the hell? And it's Greg Williams, and he starts talking. I'm like, whoa. I got to get my producer, and we get the microphone, and then I'm like, you got to tell us this on the air. I don't – like, I need everybody else to hear this. Players – like, Jordan Te'amu knew. Like, I would look at him, and he's like, no, come on. Let's do it. You know, let's go. Abe Smith was the same way. He's like, yeah, I see you waiting over there. Like, let's do it. And so it was really – like, A.J. Smith let us come up in the booth late in the season, like, sit there and talk to him. So it was really cool to have that access and then to see how it grew through the course of the season, because I think once the players and coaches figured out that we weren't going to burn them and we weren't trying to put them on blast, that process became so much easier, so much more fluid, and that made it better on television. And then to the atmospheres. I mean, St. Louis is just, God, that place is just, it. And it was like this last time. You know, we had the game last time where they, in 2020, when they opened the upper deck, and then they did it again. D.C., I finally got to go to a game in D.C. this time around. I didn't get to do that the first time I did XFL. That place is magnificent. San Antonio had some great environments. Houston was a great environment. They have passionate fans there. The way they all dress up and the different things that they got going. Like, the in-stadium experience was good, and I expect it to be better next time around. And, I think one of the things that I'm telling people after this year's been over is, like, the ball was better than I expected again. We saw some struggles with offensive line play across the board. And I think you'll see that when the rosters are put together next time, because you'll see more emphasis on, all right, we probably need to go ahead and get two extra offensive linemen or one extra than we were going to get, just so we can offset some of these injuries and manage certain things that are coming our way. The ball was better. The atmospheres were better. The access was better. And I think the league is talking to DJ and Danny a couple of times through the course of the year, like, they're set up. They're set up to go multiple seasons. They're in this for the long haul. And I think if you can grow on what you had year one, technically year one, this thing's going to be a lot of fun to watch down the road.
Yeah, D.C. security was so scared for my safety. They said at Audi Field in the championship game, because I was in my Sea Dragons, they forcibly asked me to leave the beer snake area. They said, we're scared. Because I'm a Commanders fan, so I'm like chopping it up with them about the Redskins and stuff. They go, sir, you can't be in here. We're scared for your safety. I said, okay. Don't protest. But it was a wild crowd there. Audi Field is kind of a different beast, I think.
It's a cool place. Like, that size stadium is kind of where the future, I think, needs to be for the majority of football. Neyland Stadium is amazing. And, you know, like, you go to Mercedes-Benz in Atlanta, it's awesome. You go to some of these other venues like Jordan Hare Stadium where Auburn plays, or the Big House in Michigan, you get 85, 105,000. That's great. But moving forward, that sort of quaint, crowded, like, no bad seat in the house stadium, like, that's what we need. Like, that's what we have here in Birmingham with Protective Stadium where UAB plays. Like, it's the perfect venue because you're not going to have a bad seat. Everybody's got a good line of sight, and the noise stays in. And even when you don't get a great crowd, it feels like a good crowd because the majority of the place is packed.
Last question. If XFL management called you up and said, Cole, what would you like to see us do to improve going into next year? What would you say?
Oh, to improve? You know, I would say this is one thing that I really loved the last time around. And I don't know if you recall this or not, but last time around they had the extra team that practiced every day, ran plays, went through their individual drills. So you had guys that were working out, going through actual football practice that were just waiting to be called to another team. Because I heard some of the conversations from these coaches about how they went about finding guys after injuries, like, we're calling high school coaches. We're calling college coaches. We're calling NFL guys. Like, this dude's been working at a Toyota dealership. This guy was at a grocery store. Like, this guy's out of work. Like, it, to have that extra roster of guys to be able to say, all right, we know he's – and have access to their practice film to know what they're capable of doing and if they're a good fit for you, I just think that's super valuable. I think it's worth the resources that you would put in place to have that. And I just – I think it would make it a lot easier for teams when they lost someone to be able to say, you know what, we're going to go get him and bring him in. And then he gets replaced and somebody else is practicing ready to go join another team.
Yeah, I think the Alumni Academy was like – I think that was supposed to be kind of the plan, and then I don't really know what happened with all of that. But I think that there was supposed to be some sort of like rotating section of guys there. But I agree, having that Team 9 kind of do that and having just be able to call up, especially when you're in the hub, like everyone's there. Exactly. I was surprised USFL didn't do that last year in Birmingham. I'm like, you're all in Birmingham. How hard – you know, you just have them there.
Exactly. So.
Well, Cole, I appreciate it. Like I said, saw you working hard all through the season. We were kind of on that game rotation at the end. So I appreciate it as always, and hope to see you back next year here.
Yeah, man. I appreciate you having me. A lot of fun. Appreciate your coverage of the XFL also. And I thought I was going to be able to bump into you there in San Antonio. Which once we got in that stadium, it was a busy day. Like it was nonstop.
Oh, it was very heightened on edge. I'm like, I'm standing right here. I don't want to get. I saw, you know, Jeff running around. I saw Bianca. I saw a lot of like, okay, let me stay in these ropes and let me not go into that. The last thing I want is to get evicted from San Antonio like I did the beer steak section. So
don't want that. Could not have that.
Awesome. Cool. Thanks again for your time.
Absolutely. Appreciate it.
Well, I'm excited. We had this gentleman on preseason sitting at beautiful Choctaw Stadium, now back home, you know, two-time winner now of the XFL. Congratulations. Coach Himebauch here. How are you doing?
Doing great, Reed. It's been a whirlwind, man. And excited to, you know, see this thing come to fruition, to get through a full season, and just the way that this thing ended up. I think we got everybody feeling like we were not a team to contend with over the first 6-7 weeks. They forgot about us. We weren't even on player 54 at all. And then all of a sudden, we get hot at the right time. So credit to the players, the staff. It's awesome that it all came together.
Yeah, I had chats with the player 54 people over in DC. We were watching that, watching your guys' thrilling victory there. I just landed for the Defenders game. Interesting stuff there. So you pay attention to that too, not featured on player 54.
Well, you know, we had 2 weeks to get ready for DC, and it's like we had just played them week 9. So we kind of knew what we were in store for. So I'm like, all right, let me see what's going on around the league. Well, apparently they don't think we're worth a damn. So we weren't on player 54. And, you know, we were playing really bad football for about 6-7 weeks. And we finally got it figured out at the right time.
Yeah, what was it like? I mean, obviously everyone attributes to the, you know, the we're training loose press and all that. But I mean, you're there, and you know, you also have gotten a ton of credit, even from Cole Kubelik on this episode, talking about he thinks that you should get, you know, be on to the next level here as soon as possible. But what do you attribute the success you guys found midseason?
Well, I think it starts from the top with Bob, with Coach Stoops, and it's just a come to work lunch pail type of mentality. And you know, we may not have seen the fruits of our labor, you know, show up early in the year. I mean, I think when we played San Antonio that second time, we had like 150 yards of total offense, and we all took a real deep look in the mirror, and we had to make a couple tweaks to the roster. And I think guys said, hey, let's be grateful for this opportunity. And I think you look across the board at our team, guys started playing better. They started playing cleaner. Even though we lost to Seattle, I thought that was one of the games that it started to turn for us. And just both sides of the ball. A defense played phenomenal all year. And it just took us a while to get our chemistry together on offense. And once we started firing on all cylinders, obviously the trigger man makes a huge difference. But we got some guys back healthy. When Davion was banged up for a little bit of the year, Letty had to take a lot of the work, and he got banged up. And that's spring football. You know, every week you can get beat by anybody, you know, and you look at DC, they lost to Orlando in a nail biter game. We took them down to overtime, you know, and you never quite know what you're going to get because you don't have established vets. And every week, the ball's going to bounce a certain way. And it was just a credit to our guys. They persevered, they pushed through, and really happy for them to be able to find the success at the end.
I heard, and I think it was Michael Mitchell was saying, that maybe a little bit bulletin board material with the whole 4-6 playoffs and all that. Did you buy into that, where the players were like, we're not respected, people don't think we belong here?
Whatever guys need for motivation, that motivation's like a warm bath. That thing will last for about 2 minutes and then it's over. You got to trust your technique. You got to trust the scheme, trust the system, and trust the guys around you. And I think that's what we really built. We built trust within the locker room. We had been through some adversity, and maybe some other teams hadn't been through adversity. And we found out what guys were made of. And if you can make your way through as rough of a early part of the season as we have, and got your eyes on the prize at the end. So a credit to Bob, our coordinators, both Jonathan Hayes and Chuck Long and Tim Lewis and Jay Hayes. Those guys really righted the ship. And, Scott Spurrier with special teams, and it was just steady work all the way around. And, look up at the end of the game and hopefully you got more points than the other guy. But if you sit there and you watch the scoreboard and you read press clippings, too much of that stuff's going to get in the way.
Like I said, you've gotten a lot of credit, the offensive line, Luis. I mean, there's a ton of different places to give credit. What do you attribute that such a – I mean, it never felt like the game was out of hand. I mean, obviously I'm not on the sidelines with the championship on the line, but it never seemed like it was out of hand for you guys. What do you attribute the success you had in that championship game?
Well, I think we scored fast, and I want to say we had – I don't know what the total number is, but – we had two scoring drives. We scored on the first drive, and I think we had a lot of success whenever we did score a touchdown on our first drive. Defense went 3 and out against DC, and then we went down and scored again. And so just the belief and the trust in each other started rolling. When you start that fast and the plays that we wanted, I mean, the first play, Luis is getting sacked. He's got two guys all over him, and he ends up scrambling around, making a play, gain of 7. And it was just like the stars were aligning. Just keep chipping away, boys. It may not be pretty, but just keep moving the ball.
Full circle moment for you, obviously back with the original XFL and 2020 and just standing, and I was there, and it was chaos, and you got Dany there, chairwoman, giving out the trophy. You have The Rock giving Luis the MVP. What was it like kind of being there and having everyone experience that?
I'll tell you what, man, I'm not a guy to get real nervous before games, because it's kind of like, as a coach, you've done your preparation, you trust your players, and you just want to make some adjustments as the game goes along. But I started thinking about this. I'm like, 22 years ago, I played in this. We won a championship. We had a blast. We had the best team in the XFL in 1.0 in 2001. And I was like, this could be pretty cool. I could be the only person to do this thing and do a back-to-back with 22 years in between. And I started getting a little nervous, like, man, this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. And then once the game starts, you don't even think about it. But it was really cool to get a bunch of text messages from guys that I played with 22 years ago. Tommy Maddox, Josh Wilcox, Juan Long, a bunch of guys that, I kind of lost track of. And with this game now happening, we're reconnecting, and we're going to do a podcast on my podcast here pretty soon. And with that being said, we're going to be on ours, and I'm going to have guys from our original XFL team on that one. So it's pretty cool to reconnect and see how much the game has grown. But you look back and you see the original XFL, they had cameras on the sideline. We were mic'd up. They had cameras in the locker room. And all that is what the game is now. And it's all about making it more fan-friendly and viewer-friendly, that they can see really what happened. So it was really a cool moment to be a part of it, both the first one, the second one, even though COVID hit, and then to see the third one through its entirety.
Well, I was going to say, might have to pick your Rolodex for some of these numbers, but if you're going to have them on the 5-1, that's great. I was going to say, yeah, if anyone ever replicates this, that would be something terribly wrong with the world, to go back-to-back XFL champions with another 22 years in between.
No, I hope this thing's going strong, and it does seem like it is. I know that they're talking about getting things cranked up in Arlington again in the hub with all 8 teams back again. So it's exciting to see the growth, and I think everybody's going to take a little breather here. I think everybody's going to turn their phones off. This week might be kind of the end of 2023, and then put it to bed. And then we got to start looking at guys for next season, guys that are going to NFL mini camps and who's going to rookie mini camps and all those things, because we want to continue to build the roster. So it's exciting. But I think we all need to take a little break, turn our phones off. I'm going to Cabo next week, so I'm looking forward to it, man.
Yeah, so you said you're going to, you know, take a little break here. How quick then, you know, and you've coached, I mean, how quick do you have to flip the script here? I mean, you can't rest on your laurels too much.
You know, I think everybody wants to get a little bit of a break, get through the next couple weeks, see where things go. I think once things will start to crank up, once you get into July and August again, and see who's getting invited to NFL camps, which guys do we have an option to bring back next year, who's available, which guys call it a career and walk off into the sunset after winning a championship. I'm sure we'll have a couple of our older guys on the roster bid farewell and move on to the next phase of their lives. And then we got to see what's out there. What do we need to put on the roster? And then schematically, we always want to look to get better, and what can we do and how can we go and grow and watch and learn and you know, be better teachers and be better coaches. And so it's really an ongoing evolution as you prepare for the next season.
How exciting, and we could have added 10 more here in the time that we're recording this, but how excited are you to see at least 15 guys so far getting signed to the NFL camps?
No, it's really cool. And I think the window is perfect. I know some of our guys got a little nervous because we're in the playoffs and they're seeing all these guys get tryouts and they're like, well, wait a minute, how come I can't? I said, hey, you got bigger plans, and, you know, don't look at the short term. Look, this thing's a marathon, not a sprint. So I know that there's some interest. There's some phone calls. Our guys are going to do some workouts. It was hard when I coached in the USFL last year. Those guys weren't done until July, and it was hard to make OTAs and make a roster. You see a ton of guys getting picked up for workouts and now getting signed. It's really exciting, and that's what we want this league to be, a league of opportunity. And to turn around and see guys playing in the fall on Sundays in the NFL, that's awesome. And that's what you want this thing to be. It's a platform for them to show their abilities, but also go to the next phase of their career.
We talked, you know, you were on preseason, really excited. We talked your transition from the USFL here. What worked or didn't work? Well, first off, what worked or didn't work from your opinion in the XFL this year?
I think the thing that worked is everybody came in with the right type of mindset. Guys wanted to get film. They wanted to get on the field. It would have been nice for everybody on the roster to be active game day. And that was one of the things that the league did right. They let everybody on the roster play in the championship game. I think that's something that needs to be expressed to those that are watching the league. They may not know that. There were six players each week that we had to put down and make inactive, and they're not making the same money. And so I think the league realized the more players we put on the field, the better the product's going to be. And I thought that was a pretty exciting game in the championship. I know that we would like to get with other teams during preseason. That was one of the things. We didn't have a preseason game, which is why football was a little rough early on. You need to go through some of those, line up against somebody in an opposite color jersey. There's a ton of different things I think we're going to learn from it. There's a ton of leadership in our league that has asked for suggestions and how we get this thing better. But I think it's all in all a success, and excited to see the growth of this league as it continues.
Now, that was going to be a follow-up. Is, do you feel like, you know, ownership and management, they are open to that? You know, because this is, you know, we have years of experience and all this, but to get everyone in and trying to do a football league like this, do you think that they're receptive to feedback that you guys have?
I think so. They have been all year open to doing some different things with the roster. And that's good to see from our leadership, and really got a great relationship with a lot of the folks. I mean, you look at, you know, Bob as one of the head coaches that has come back. So I know he has some strong insight to what's happening with the league and where it's going. So, really feel like it's trending in the right direction, and we got to continue to grow. We got to grow on the field. We got to get more players. We need to get more coaches involved. I think the audience was surprised and excited about what the talent was on the field. I think the ratings were pretty good in the championship game. Somebody just shot me a text that it was like 1.4 million viewers on ABC. So that's cool. There's an appetite for this, and this thing's going to grow, and great opportunity for players, coaches, staff, trainers, equipment, everybody. I mean, stadiums need people in the seats, and people need something to watch in the springtime. So it's a win, and we hope it continues.
Preseason, you mentioned you thought the timing, and here again, you know, the timing compared to the USFL, that was one of the reasons why you wanted to go from the USFL back to the XFL. Is that still, do you believe, the XFL's strongest selling point? Is it the collection of coaches and staff you guys have, you know, ownership? What do you think is the XFL's strongest position right now, what gives them that?
I think everything needs to be centered around the players, and when the players are leaving other leagues to come to this one because of the calendar, they really steer the ship. Viewership, yes, I know it's tough leading up and going against March Madness. It's tough going against the Masters. It's tough against the Derby and all those things. But people that are football junkies, they're going to watch it. They love seeing it. And these players need time to recover and get ready for NFL camps. And that's hard to do when you're finishing a championship game on the 4th of July weekend. So I think if everything we do is based around the players, then we're on the right track. And so when guys are showing up and appreciative of the opportunity, then we need to keep focus on that.
In terms of the time you spent in Birmingham last year versus in Arlington, better or worse, what did you make of your time this year?
Both great, you know, both really run at a high level. Loved working for Skip Holtz last year. Great football mind, excellent leader, first time coaching pro football, and you'd never know it. And, you know, working for Bob, I think just those two strong leaders who have a ton of success at the college level, it all starts with them. But as far as both leagues, both have great bonuses to it, great opportunities for coaches and players. So loved them both. It got a little bit toasty in Birmingham when we were hitting it in July. I will tell you that, man, that was starting to get a little smoky down there in the South during that time. But I guess we had to deal with the ice storms in Texas when we had camp. So you got to deal with it in the springtime, but both great opportunities. Loved them both.
In terms of, you know, moving into next year, you've talked, you think having more active players. I had Cole Kublik on. He's talking, you know, we got to get back kind of the team nine, whatever, with the XFL getting that. What other changes, if they, you know, if they called you up and said anything you want next year, what would you look for?
Yeah, go ahead and double that coach's salary. That'd be great. I think, the more players we can get on the roster, the more guys we get in training camp, whether we can do a mini camp, those are all things that would be great just to be around the guys. And I think having a basis going into next season, guys are going to have a grasp of what the schemes are. We have an idea of who we play. We had no clue what we were walking into week one against Vegas. I mean, you try to look back at what history coaches have, but some of those things, and it's only going to get better. So the more players we have, I think by doing the hub, really helped players get healthy. They were right there training with Coach Tom Shaw, and Tom Shaw is one of the greatest in the world of player development. And so credit to him and his staff getting guys back on the field. That's a huge plus. So I think if we can have guys on the ready and that, whatever you want to call it, team nine developmental program, or players that you would release and they're still around nearby, it's only going to help, because it's vicious in a 10-game cycle. It's an irregular calendar, and so guys are going to get banged up. It's the nature of the game. There was no bye week, and when you go 5 weeks of camp, 10 in the regular season, that's a grind. So I would love to see a bye week maybe right in the middle. You can rotate if, you know, two teams are off week 3, 4, 5, 6, however you do that. I know that prolongs the season a week, but we did have a bye week before the regular before the semis and the championship game. So I know it's all based on TV, and that's the one that steers the ship. But I know we're talking and in discussions, but loved every aspect of it, and excited to see where it goes from here.
Yeah, no, you're the Professor Andrew Murray. We were just talking, and we on our recap from the championship of having, you know, that the month of March Madness that we were all so scared of. Yeah, take two teams every week, roll that bye week out, then you're only worried about scheduling the other three games, and then people can, you know, you pair it off, maybe kind of like the CFL, and give some bye weeks there in the middle.
Yeah, I think so. And, it, you know, it's all about venue availability. I know that Seattle – where you're a fan of is had to deal with a couple of like Thursday games. That's rough. That's rough for guys. They had a rough go early on. I know they had some real short weeks, and that takes a toll on guys. So it's something that, there's a lot of different things you got to look at. If it was a perfect, easy equation, you know, everybody would be doing this. So we trust in the leadership. We look at where this thing's going after year one. I'm sure there's some tweaks that the top of the league wants to have also.
I'll let you go here. Enjoy your vacation. Final thoughts, reflections. It's just exciting. Like I said, you know, who would have thought all year, and you guys, and just everything you went through. And when they traded for Luis, I thought that's not going to matter at all. This is like, you know, it's good for him. And I'm excited to see that. And then here being in the playoffs and the championship, tremendously excited. Anything else from you?
No, it's really cool to see a team come together. Yeah, we were kind of the island of misfit toys for a while, and we got it figured out. And credit to Luis, you know, he really came in and worked, and the guys gravitated towards him based on his work, not what he said. And I know everybody sees the sound bites and this and that and the rah-rah, this stuff. That's hardly him. He's in there putting coaches' hours in. He's first in, last out. And that's how you need to be as a professional quarterback. He's got big goals. He's been in the NFL. He wants to get back. And I think he showed everybody how to be a professional football player. This is not roll in at 5 minutes before meetings and leave at 2 o'clock. And, you know, what are you going to do? I mean, you're there to play ball. And I think he really galvanized our locker room, was a great coach on the field. And so credit to him. He really did it in a short amount of time. And you look and see how the team reacted to him. So credit to him, credit to all the guys that they just persevered and pushed through it. And we were excited at the end of the year to say, hey, we got a couple more points than those guys, and happy that they can hopefully save some of that bonus money instead of probably most of it was already spent before we won. But happy for the boys. They got to drink out of the cup. We put the trophy to new use by tipping that thing upside down and drinking out of it. Kind of the Stanley Cup-ish type of deal, like the Grey Cup. But awesome experience, Reed. Was fired up to be a part of this thing and looking forward to next season.
I have one bonus question. I lied, but that's exciting because we cover the CFL. We've had a lot of, you know, Jim Mullins of the world and, you know, up there. And it, yeah, what's the point of a trophy if you can't drink out of it? Well, you guys, so you manufactured your own. I haven't seen videos of this. You flipped the cup over, you flipped the trophy over and drank out the base.
Yeah, there were some guys being creative with celebratory toasts in the locker room. So I'm sure something will surface here if you keep searching on some of the guys' IG feeds. There's some interesting people that were drinking out of the cup also in the locker room at the Alamo Dome. I'll make you do your homework, man.
Last thing, do you attribute, obviously you being in this before, Coach Stoops, you know, the Hayes brothers, everybody else, being able, just having that many kind of returning people in that fashion to be able to kind of figure out this monster that is spring football and kind of the weird timing and you know, just kind of everything that goes along with that?
Yeah, I think it did help. I mean, Bob's leadership was a huge part of it. But, you know, when you have multiple coaches on our staff, Tim Lewis, who was a head coach in the Alliance of American Football, Jonathan Hayes, who was the head coach at Seattle or St. Louis, those guys and the background that they have, understanding how to put a roster together, how to manage practices, practice schedules, you know, just play count. I mean, all those little things that you think about and how much the guys can handle, because it really, truly was kind of like putting together an all-star team for a number of months. And the sooner you can gel and put a team together, it's going to show up on the field. So I guess it took us a little while. We didn't start figuring it out till midseason, but all those experiences definitely did help us.
Well, congratulations again, 2-time XFL champion. Really appreciate it. Go enjoy your vacation. And that, you know, I'm bald too, so make sure you put some sunscreen on there. So we got to make sure that.
Thanks, Reed. Appreciate it, man.
Thank you. Well, here we are back again. We've been through many different things with Jim Mullin here. We went through back with the XFL-CFL merger talks, and then when the CFL was going to get rid of the ratio and change to four downs during all this, you know, the CBA negotiations. Jim's been on, but Jim promised hot takes today, XFL, USFL, just because Jim, you know, like I've said in the intro here, you know, been involved in Canadian football for generations, you know, covering everything. We'll then transition into the CFL XFL stuff and kind of begin our coverage there. Jim, how are you doing?
Good. How are you? You're looking casual, man. You're looking like you're in Margaritaville out there.
I got my Mountain Dew. No, I got my Mountain Dew. This is the summer here at the Mark House. I sit out on the deck here. It's really nice. And it's good. So, Jim, you know, we've talked a lot, you know, all the back through with Danny and Dwayne and everything, talking with the CFL. You have now lived through the XFL. I mean, we've done it. We've crowned a champion. I was there. What did you make XFL 3.0?
I'm going to focus specifically on the championship game. And, you know, quite frankly, I thought in terms of presentation, it was a bit of a wet firecracker. And what I mean by that is that, you know, for a championship game, I expect a level of energy to it. And you know, maybe it's not to be placed on the XFL. Maybe it's to be placed on the broadcaster in this case. But I just didn't feel the energy of a championship game. I didn't feel that ESPN, ABC did the job that they needed to do in terms of camera angles, broadcast crew. It did flow to me, and so on that level, I was disappointed. I'm sure if the XFL could do it all over again. Regardless of whether or not St. Louis was in the final or not, they would have moved that game to St. Louis. And I probably see that in their future. The other thing with the XFL is that, you know, this was a very not Vince XFL. And, you know, with Vince, that's where you get the firecracker, quite frankly. And so I'm not sure if, just as a casual viewer of that league, if I was, you know, with The Rock kind of being the mascot of it, I'm not even going to say that he was the operator of it. It was Danny and Redbird and all of those other pieces that you had this expectation that it would still be in that pocket, but it was nowhere near that pocket in terms of that level of energy overall through the year. As a developmental league, I think they did an outstanding job. I think you're seeing the net result of that very quietly, mind you, in terms of the transition of the number of players from the XFL into NFL camps. I would suspect that you might see a number of those players back in the XFL at some point in time, but they're getting their shot, and that's the main thing here. And over the long term, that's the thing that's probably going to make the XFL viable, if they can find viable markets to kind of make some of their venues pop. Never go back to Cashman Field again. Never go back there again.
We're taking season ticket deposit season two there. That'll be at least through 2 years. I think we'll be at Cashman Field.
I remember it in minor league baseball, of course, but you know, maybe there's a different way they can configure that. Like, you know, quite frankly, looking at Cashman Field and then comparing it to an empty stadium in the USFL, I would take an empty stadium in the USFL. And because maybe I've been to enough low-level spring games in my life and on the college side that I can be accustomed to that, or maybe you've been to enough college games in Canada that I can be adjusted to that. In terms of everything, in terms of game presentation, I think it was very hit and miss for the XFL. And, you know, one of the pieces that we were just talking about off air, if we want to get into the comparison of things, you know, I put the question out there to people on Twitter, you know, why is it that I like the USFL better than the XFL? You know, not by a wide margin, mind you. You know, I've got room for both of them in my life, but why is it? And it occurred to me just before we came on this, like, we're of two different generations. I like the USFL because the USFL was in my life for 3 years when I was much younger, and all of the excitement around that league, all of those brands, even though I don't like it when they call up the old USFL in the USFL broadcast. So, you know, some of those brands, some of that pattern, it's familiar to me. And Certainly, they don't have the level of innovation that the XFL has on the field in terms of some of the rules. And it just plays better for somebody who's Gen X like myself. And I'm sure, Reed, that when it comes to the USFL, seeing the Michigan Panthers doesn't fire you up because you remember them from the first USFL championship, right?
I missed all that. You know, I mean, I was born in 86, so it doesn't do anything.
The death year of the USFL. That's got something to do with it, right?
The broadcast brought it. Yeah, I've been thinking a lot about this, and I think I'm going to record with Mike here. We'll post these, obviously, out of order. But, you know, having spent the weekend with the XFL people, right, and, you know, where I'm on the sidelines and talking with people before the game and during and in the press box, I think that there was this expectation of what people had in 2020, right? And who knows if that would have been sustainable, right? I mean, we don't know. And Vince was, you know, setting fire to money and we're burning through all this stuff, you know, but that existed and people had expectations. I think the people in the XFL this year kind of know, okay, this is the budget we're working with. This is kind of what the stakes were at right now. And I mean, I think they, having lived through it for the year, take it very personally as a success, right? Feel very much like they succeeded in that way. And for the metrics they have, and if it's what they're, you know, what they're saying is true, I do think that they have succeeded in those metrics. It just happens to be those metrics are a lot lower, right, than what the XFL was. And my last point is, you know, with the USFL, they somehow have been able to adopt this underdog mentality, right? Like, we're the upstart spring football league, but yet you're owned by one of the largest conglomerations in all of sports media. Like, I don't get that. Like, yes, it's the USFL, but it is the, you know, the smaller bank account of Fox back. You know, like, it's all still, I don't know how they've been able to be, quote unquote, an underdog in this, like being financed in the way that they are.
All they've done is they've taken the story from the 1980s around the USFL, and without the star power on the field, they've applied it again to what they're doing right now. Like, they, one of the reasons that the USFL had a chance is because they signed the original one is because they signed a giant deal with ABC Sports that people didn't expect that they'd have back in the day. And that put them on a pretty solid footing to try some expansion pieces, and then they got too big for their britches and started spending money in the wrong directions. So that spring startup underdog league piece fits with all of that branding that they brought from the 80s. They've just transported it over to, it's like a remake of a movie from the 80s, right?
But it feels, you get what I mean? Like, and I get all these people online that are like, I go, Fox Sports does not need, I mean, not that Redbird needs to either, but Fox Sports does not need you defending them in any regard. I mean, they have more money than every single, you know, I mean, they will be fine whether the USFL succeeds or not.
Well, I have to say, I do like Fox Sports coverage better than what I saw in and around the XFL this year too. So, which is unfortunate in that, you know, when you have a product like the XFL that is trying more things, that is trying to be more innovative, and you have a broadcast partner that isn't elevating that the way it necessarily should in comparison to the competing product. That's what makes it, at least from the outside looking in, a bit of a struggle for me to kind of elevate the XFL over the USFL at this stage. But, you know, I suspect in about 3 years, we're talking about pieces of both those leagues functioning in one league that at the end of the day will be probably finally the path to successful spring football in the U.S.
Yeah, you're not the only one that is. And I have many ESPN friends that have come on the show. You're not the only one that has said that they prefer the Fox broadcast over the ESPN broadcast.
Yeah, well, I mean, I have a show on TSN, which is 20% owned by ESPN. So, you know, to come out and say something like that, I mean, it's a bit of a challenge for myself to say it, but I know what my eyes see. And even though there's not unique USFL branding within what Fox does, they still did a better job so far, at least, of packaging it up. And I expect to see More electricity around the USFL playoffs in the final than what we saw out of the XFL.
Last question, because I do want to get to CFL stuff. You know, I feel it's fair to say a lot of CFL people felt threatened during all this XFL stuff, right? Or, you know, and you know, identities and our game was being questioned, and like we needed all of this stuff. You know, I think the expectations were probably high that the XFL was going to come out, maybe from Canadian people, right or wrong, going to get 10 million viewers. And, you know, Marshall Ferguson's getting on there and tweeting, oh, this is terrible football. I'm like, it's the second week of an expansion league. Mm-hmm. How did you, I think you probably had a more realistic expectation of what it was going to look like, both on the field and in terms of ratings. How do you think that it performed?
You know what, when I look at where it's at right now, and I'm not sure if you got this impression from talking with XFL people around the sidelines, like you were mentioning, I think that they were willing to take a look at where they were in the football world, knowing that the NFL is the major league, knowing that the CFL is AAA, and they came in somewhere between single A and double A, and they're willing to work their way up. I believe that there's a larger game here and a longer path for them. This isn't going to be done in 1 year. This is not the AAF. This is something that has a strategy around at least a 3-year window. And when we wake up at the end of that 3-year window, if they are sitting in a solid AAA position, you know, then they're the ones that are going to carry spring football forward. How that has an effect on the Canadian Football League. Well, that'll be up to the Canadian Football League and their minds to decide that. Now, do they go more in with Canadians on the field? Do they open the market up? Because there were Canadians that have made it to both spring leagues. You know, we just had Sidney Brown sign a $5.6 million deal in the NFL as a defensive back, like with 28 Canadians in the NFL. It never used to be the case in the CFL. We used to have all the best Canadians in the CFL. They're in the NFL now. NFL Canada is marketing those Canadians quite aggressively. So, you know, it's time for the CFL to keep an eye on what's going on down there, develop their own brand, work on what they need to sell, define what they are, sell what they have, right? It's still the second best league in the world until someone proves otherwise.
Well, and if nothing else, like, you know, we've talked before on here, and I think Dave Naylor's been on as well, talking that, you know, if there is more players that end up staying in America, you know, to get these positions, you know, looking more at the other Canadian players to boost them up, you know, it creates more jobs across the board, whatever way you look at it, because the CFL is going to have to find more people to fill, or, you know, the XFL, USFL, you know, it's... Overall, across the board, it's elevating players on both sides, right, to find more positions to play.
Well, I also think that what's going to naturally happen is that the typical CFL imports age will go up, because you'll have younger players that have been cut off NFL rosters trying to dive in with the USFL or the XFL and get that chance because they see it as the shortest route back to a National Football League camp. And, you know, getting older players up here isn't the worst thing in the world, right? The only issue with it is that you have shorter careers and then you can't build brands up around the players that eventually end up here. But I do see that probably as a longer term trend if there is a successful league that operates in that spring space in the United States.
So, you know, transition to CFL, obviously you're, you know, up there in BC, exciting, you know, for the Lions. We've had Vernon on here kind of getting, it was a weird year last year. And I think Vernon was very open in his interview on here talking about having to, I think he had three different places he was paying rent for and having to move and, you know, learn a new playbook and all of this stuff. How do you feel now? You know, Vernon's in charge. We've got the Arrow Up episodes by Matt and Nick that I think are phenomenal. I text Matt all the time. I'm watching them, you know, whatever the heck they were doing, you know, buying Hawaiian barbecue or whatever and trying to do it. You know, I have been at many of the places. It's kind of like watching the Canadian documentary about my own, you know, my own backyard. But what do you make of the Lions heading into the season?
Well, you know, I think Amar Doman's made a lot of the right moves, considering that he probably had the single biggest challenge throwing his way out of any of the CFL teams, and that was losing Nathan Rourke to the NFL. I think the Lions handled that file well. I think Nathan Rourke handled that file well, and I believe that the Lions won't be shy in promoting Rourke's involvement at the NFL level in the future. So that they're going to turn that into a positive story about his origin in professional football. That's the way to do it now. That's the way the market is. I will say about Vernon Adams, he's always been one of my favorites, quite frankly, even though he's had issues with consistency over the years. I think that during the time where he in his younger career here, where he bounced around and maybe didn't have the focus and dedication that he should have, there was a season a couple of years ago in Montreal where he changed his attitude and he changed his focus and he changed his approach, and he matured. He was like one of those older players that I'm talking about that could eventually come to Canada. He's had that growth period, though, in the CFL. And I'm really looking forward to seeing what happens with VA here. He's got I love his personality in terms of being the guy that you put on the poster and what he can lead with. I like how he creates excitement, sometimes negatively, most of the time positively. I think in terms of what was available on the market, you couldn't find a better guy to build around to replace a guy like Nathan in this market. And I think there's a few other things that the Lions have done in regard to branding. I like what they've done with the new uniform. Would have liked it better if they had a stripe on the helmet. That's who I am, but that's okay. I like what they've done with the uniform and the branding. I think it was a little overdue, quite frankly. And there's another piece in this, and I've been heavily involved in it, and I'm not sure if anybody in the stateside has picked this up, but I know a few outlets picked it up. Simon Fraser University is the only Division II team in Canada playing in, the only foreign school in the NCAA. They made a decision to cancel their football program on April the 4th. When all of the scholarship money is used up, these kids can't move, they can't transfer. There's transferable credits from Canadian schools to America, all kinds of problems around that. So, I jumped in my Football Canada role and helped the alumni put together a media campaign that really took off. And one of the reasons that it really took off is because Amar Doman jumped on board. And quite frankly, in terms of being a leader in the football community, a leader in BC, quite frankly, to step up for these student athletes, for this program, and to literally put $500,000 down to say, hey, I'm putting this money down. We're going to raise some money. I'm going to step up behind this team. Time to bring it back. Calling out the university. Like, he was not afraid. He pinned his ears back. He was not afraid to call out Simon Fraser on this in the way that they made their decision. Like that galvanizes a community around you. At least it galvanizes the football community around you. And it shows investment in the community. As much as David Braley, the previous owner, the late David Braley, managed to keep the Lions alive here for the better part of two decades. Even with David, we lacked that presence in this market, and that sort of energy that Amar's bringing, like, you can't manufacture that. Either it comes from the person or it doesn't. Like, you can't have spin doctors put that together, right? So given where this market is at with a failing hockey team. you wouldn't know anything about that in Seattle. You guys actually go to the playoffs after 2 years. A soccer team that is not on anyone's radar anymore because of their broadcast agreement with Apple TV. Like, they've dropped off the map, and their attendance has dropped as well. I think the BC Lions are in a position to really capitalize on this if VA stays healthy and, you know, there's a good framework around them. You know, the Lions could be a pretty good ticket this year in this community.
Well, I like the, because I think it was last year they kind of teased, or we did a little bit of the alt jersey stuff. I texted Baker. I said, I want to know when the Marcast gets to the level, like when I get my own jersey sent to me. Because like Donnie and Dahl, like they had them sent and they're doing, I'm sure you have one somewhere in the
closet. No, I don't. I just get the old stuff. I got an old helmet here. That's all I got.
I said, I want to know when
they send me their junk.
I think I got a sticker once. I think I got a sticker sent to me. But I said, I want to know when that's my New Year's resolution is. I want to get the Marcast to the level in the CFL community where we get that. But I do, speaking of the Lions and Vernon, what's really struck me, and I know that Ottawa does the behind the R thing too, very different feel for the arrow up. I think that the Lions this year with Lucky and Keon and Vernon and like they have such a likable group of guys, and mm-hmm. Dane Evans is kind of hanging around. Like it's such a marketable, and I don't know if that's like we got some ex NFL people in there. You know, Lucky doesn't care and he's kind of going, you know, just does whatever he wants to do. But it feels like you can build a lot around that in terms of, you know, like is Trevor Harris the most exciting person in the world? Like, you know what I mean? Like Cody's kind of got a little bit of swag, but I think that whole Lions offensive group has a lot of juice to them.
Yeah. And if they perform even halfway up to the level of their personality, it'll be easier to sell tickets. The other piece around this in terms of the marketing piece is who is Amar going to bring in for the opening concert? I mean, that was a signal that concert last year. Where they, you know, got close to 40,000. And I'm not sure how many of them returned, but it created energy, right? It created energy around the product. So now the product is becoming the energy, and that's what's really encouraging here, right?
Well, also, I mean, the fact that, you know, the Lions, you know, made it to the playoffs, you know, got far. It's like the same with the Kraken. You know, I mean, like people, I think people, you know, I've talked with more people about the Kraken in the last month that are going to, you know, want to return. Oh, God, I missed out. I didn't even know this was going on. And, you know, you want to get that in BC too. Well, you know, they took Winnipeg and I don't know. I don't know if that was the best game in the world against Winnipeg, but at least we were there, you know what I mean?
Well, the other thing too was, you know, Nathan Rourke's recovery through that. I mean, that became a story in itself. And the fact that, you know, he could have easily tapped out because he knew that there was NFL interest out there. He didn't have to come back and play in that game. He didn't have to risk himself. You know, but he did. And, you know, that even though he's not on the team now, that makes people buy into the importance of what goes on the field in a CFL game. So, you know, I think there have been a lot of wins here for this team. A lot of it's been driven by ownership. I think you've mentioned some of the staff efforts. I'm really hoping that they amplify the personality of this team now, so the personality becomes part of the brand.
We could go on a long time, but I don't want this episode to be 18 hours today. I do have a question for you though. McLeod Bethel-Thompson's on this show as well. You know, he, right. And very excited to talk with him just because we've tracked him for years. When he left the CFL, he, you know, wrote a really long verbose, you know, Instagram post and really thanked, you know, really romanticized the game. When Nathan left, you know, it was more of a, you know, the CFL was a detour. I don't know if I wanted that, but I had to do that. And now we're here. Like, did you like how the two or have any thought about how the two different kind of high profile quarterbacks decided to leave the CFL?
Well, I think you're dealing with two individuals of different ages that, you know, and MBT, like he had more than a few years up here, right? To experience that. And you've also got, you know, as much as Nathan is together as an individual and is usually always on message, you know, he's still a young guy. That's one of the reasons why the NFL's interested in him, right? Was because of his age. I think the one thing that we're seeing about McLeod though is, you know, playing in the USFL, playing in the Spring League. Remember, I was talking about double A, triple A, single A. Yeah, like here's a, you know, a triple A quarterback showing that we're kind of high A, you know, long season, if we're using a baseball metaphor here. Like, he is head and shoulders above everybody else in that league right now. And I you know, respectfully, I think if you put him in the XFL, you know, he might be head, shoulders, and waist above everybody in that league as well. So, you know, I'm happy that you have him on the show. I'm looking forward to seeing him. I'm not sure if your viewers are seeing me first or him first. I think I'm probably ninth in the batting order right now. Am I not?
No, you're going to lead into McLeod. So if you have anything say to McLeod, you can lead in here. Yeah,
I'm privileged. Yeah. And also, by the way, wearing one of my favorite USFL brands, the Boston, New Orleans, Portland Breakers.
They're not playing in New Orleans right now. Well, Jim, I appreciate it. Now I am getting excited for the CFL. I've kind of lived through, it's been a lot of XFL here since November with the draft and all of that, and getting through the Grey Cup and everything with the CFL. But coming back around, I'm excited. I got to figure out my summer wedding schedule, but we'll probably be coming up to BC. It's a little lighter this year. People were COVID wedding happy last year, so I think I'll have a couple of free weekends, so it should be good.
Well, and the other part is that I know I'm getting down for a Mariners game sometime this summer. So if you don't get up here, I'm going to be coming down and seeing you and Dorothy down there for a Mariners game.
Well, that'll be good. We'll welcome you with open arms. Jim Mullin, President of Football Canada, and then obviously host of Crown Gridiron Nation on TSN. Appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks, Anna. And I'm also on that IFAF board, too.
The so, IFAF. Oh,
yeah.
And saving
that keeps me football. Busy. Yeah.
Well, this is a gentleman I've been wanting to talk to since I saw him throwing a football around in the Alamo Dome back in the Spring League. McLeod Bethel-Thompson, how are you doing, sir?
Doing great. Appreciate you having me on.
Yeah, we had on, who was it, Matthew Sexton a couple weeks ago. We were talking old Spring League stuff as well, and the Aviators and the Hughes and kind of everything else with that. You are, you know, in Birmingham now. How's your life going? How is McLeod's life?
It's really good, man. I'm so happy to be here. The reason why we made this decision is for family, and I got my wife and my daughter here today. So we're planning to go to a Birmingham Barons game tonight, have some hot dogs, and watch some baseball, and hang out with my beautiful family. So I'm a happy camper.
How has the city of Birmingham feel like adopted you and kind of the USFL and everything else?
Yeah, it's great getting to know the town. You know, I'm a California kid. I'm a West Coast kid. So Birmingham feels like a different world. But I really like a lot of people I've met. And we've been hitting a lot of restaurants and trying to explore and get to know people down here. So every day is an adventure, and I'm appreciative of every moment I have. And most of all, I'm just happy to be with my family and spending quality time.
It's awesome. Yeah, we'll talk CFL stuff. It's funny to me, just like I said, coming off the top with the Spring League and everything else, now here you find yourself back in the USFL, which, you know, is kind of begat from the Spring League and all that. Is it weird kind of full circle and just how your journey has kind of led you through all this stuff?
It's crazy. You know, for a long time, I was jealous of other people's journey, other people that felt like I could play better than and had different success in other leagues or got more kudos. And as it happened the last couple of years, and I've really come into my own as a player, I'm just so appreciative of my journey and where my feet are, and so appreciative of every opportunity I get to strap pads up and play football at a professional level and play football at the highest level. I'm just really appreciative and satisfied and grateful for every opportunity, and just loving the team, loving the Breakers organization. You know, I really love Coach Flip and the brothers I have in that locker room. Got a lot of really good men, and just enjoying building those bonds and just being grateful playing the game I love on a week in and week out basis.
Yeah, how has it kind of been getting into the organization there? Paul Woods was on a couple weeks ago. I know he's helping write a book about you and everything else. Talking about, you know, they said you were going to have to earn your spot, that there was no guarantees coming in. What was it like kind of coming in? Is, you know, I don't talk to many people that are near my age, and I'm still older than you, but, you know, you're on the other side of a lot of the guys on the roster.
Yeah, it's good. It's you got a lot of young, really good football players. And speaking in the quarterback room, you have two really good football players in Aquil Glass and Davis Cheek, and it was cool to come in and not get that, you know, that special treatment. Just go in there and grind it out and throw and try to compete at a high level throughout camp. And nothing was given. And it's cool. I'm not afraid to compete. I'm not afraid to throw with anybody. And I learn something from those guys every single day. So I just love the game of football, you know, and the Breakers organization is all about practicing fast, and we're swagger and we're confidence, and we want to play fast, and we want to, we all love the game of football. So, and that starts with Coach Flip. So, it is different being on the older side of it. And I get different questions or get different, you know, needlings from the young guys or whatever. But a wise poet once said that age ain't nothing but a number. So I'm just being 100% where my feet are and just trying to play my best football if I can.
Well, because I would think if I was a young player, I would appreciate, right, having someone in this, you know, you do any of these spring football, it's such a, you know, you got to come in and get your feet going. You know, I could see other people being, hey, this guy's coming in, time to take a spot. So just always interesting how all the different, you know, guys on the roster are going to take that.
Yeah, for sure. You know, it can, there can be a moment where it's like, man, what are you doing in this league? You've got to already stab yourself in another league, and now you're coming here to play. And the reason for that is just exposure and being with my family. And I truly am an open book, and I want to leave every place I am better than I found it. And I want to give more than I receive on a daily basis. I don't do this game for fame or for kudos or for anything else, but just chasing my best self and how I can help others along the way. So I truly am trying to give the most I possibly can to my teammates, whether that's, you know, helping out DBs or safeties with what I'm seeing they're doing, or helping out other quarterbacks in my position. I truly want to leave this a better place than I found it. And I'm excited to do that on a day in day out basis and earn people's trust and confidence that I'm a good teammate, and I will do everything I can possibly to help them.
How have you graded your own performance? Obviously, numbers so far have been good, right? Breakers, and this will air next week, but, you know, Breakers undefeated at this point, looking good. How would you gauge your own, how you've performed?
Yeah, so far, I'm my harshest critic. You know, I feel like our offense is really dynamic at this point. We have the potential of just going out there and dominating folks, but we haven't done that yet, you know? And it's professional football, so you can't just roll the ball out there and expect to dominate. So I expect myself to play at an elite level. And am I ever satisfied? Absolutely not. You know, I find, you know, there's two or three plays in every game that I want back and I want to correct. And, you know, this last game is no exception. Playing the Generals, I felt like we came out sloppy, and kudos to them. They're a good defense, but we want to perform at a high level. And when I go up there and have 70 snaps in a game, I want 70 unbelievable snaps. And that's why I'm playing the game, is to chase this perfection. And this, it takes, you know, body, mind, and soul to play the quarterback position. It's an emotional, it's a physical, and it's really a spiritual journey as well too. So I'm trying to find that secret sauce where I can just make every play work and be dynamic for 70 plays. And so I haven't achieved that yet. And so since I haven't achieved that, I'm going to go out there this next Sunday and try to chase it then. And really enjoying that process.
It's funny because, you know, I've heard the announcers and Kurt and everyone, and, you know, obviously a lot's focused on your CFL background, but, you know, I mean, you've played, you know, many a different NFL roster and squad, and like we've talked about the spring league. Is it funny that you've that kind of stigma is on you now, or what do you make of that and a lot of the story around you being from the CFL?
Oh, that's for other people to tell, right? You know, that's, you know, looking on the flip side, maybe I'll get an announcing on that side, and then it'll be my job to tell the story. But right now, I just got to walk the walk. So I don't mind it. You know, people, you can't control what people write about you, good, bad, or indifferent. But you can only control, you know, how you take one step in front of the other and how you move on a daily basis. So just trying to move in the right way, fight the good fight, and keep playing good football if I can for as long as possible.
Talk about the talent level, not only on your team, but the other rosters. Obviously, we have other CFL guys, even on the Breakers. But, you know, I've had people say, oh, McLeod should just come in here and run circles around because it's all these, you know, minor league players. But obviously, there's a high level of talent, whether it's the USFL or the XFL.
Absolutely. You know, I mean, there's good football players everywhere. And that's what the great thing is about this league, is that the more football there is, the more jobs there are in professional football, the better for everybody. The better the product's going to go, the better the product's going to be. And to be honest, let's be totally transparent, the better the NFL is going to be. We saw some sloppy football in the NFL last year, and especially in the middle stretches, because they don't have that quote-unquote middle class of the NFL, right? It's really high-paid players and then a lot of young rookies. And college football just doesn't prepare professional football players. You know, it's a different game. So the more opportunities there are professional football, the better it is for everyone, and there's good football players everywhere. Obviously, in these leagues, it's a younger crop, right? You're not going to have the veterans of the CFL or the veterans of the NFL, so you're not going to have that experience, but you got good football players everywhere, and anytime you get paid to strap it up and go play football, you better put your big boy pants on because it's going to be a good matchup, and that's what we're looking to do week in, week out.
How hard was it to decide to leave the CFL? I thought you wrote a really touching, you know, post when you decided to go. We were covering the Grey Cup when, you know, the Argos won back in November in Regina. What was it like to kind of say goodbye?
It was tough, man. It truly was, and I have so much love for that league. That's such a historic league. That game is a beautiful game. It's a really, really hard game. I don't think people give that credit how difficult that game is. Three downs, you know, 12 men on the field, three safeties instead of two. Really, it's a totally fluid game. The high motion, it's very complicated, very hard on the quarterback. It's a beautiful game, and, you know, and it challenges you in a lot of different ways, because I believe that when people put their blood, sweat, and tears into a single endeavor, and it's done over 107 years or, you know, whatever, the 9 years, whatever the Grey Cup has been going, that stuff builds up, you know. So there's a lot of kinetic energy just sitting in those games and in those stadiums. And there's a lot of people have poured so much of themselves into that game. I truly love the CFL game. I think it's a fantastic game, a fantastic league. And so it was tough to leave. And it was tough to leave my brothers in Toronto because I built some really good friendships there. But this was the right decision for me. I'm so appreciative to be here. I'm appreciative for the USFL for the opportunity and the coverage. And I'm just loving playing football and being with my family on a week in, week out basis.
It struck with me because obviously around the same time we saw the whole Nathan Rourke thing and he had posted, and, you know, it was kind of the CFL was an unexpected detour, I think was the wording he used. And it just felt like to have that then juxtaposed with what you had said, it just really struck, I think, a lot of people in a positive way, right, of just the reverence that you have for that. I think it was really well appreciated.
Thank you. Yeah, it's a beautiful league, and I'm so grateful for my time in there. It tested me, man. It did not take it easy on me for 5 years there. It really tested my mettle, and it made me become a stronger person, much less a stronger football player. And I'm really appreciative of that forever. I will always be a CFL fan, and I will always be a Toronto Argonaut, you know. So I really appreciate my time there and the brotherhood I built. And I have so many lifelong friendships and so many memories. So much love for that league up there.
It's funny because we talk now, and obviously with you being in the USFL, a lot more questions about you and the CFL. And, you know, I think people think that you're coming in as this, you know, big star. And obviously, you know, here with the Argos and winning the Grey Cup, but, you know, you fought for everything that you had every year in the CFL. I mean, it wasn't until, you know, year before last where you were even kind of given that starting position that, you know, it wasn't like you were some bona fide mega hit star, like, okay, now he's moving on to the next thing. I mean, you fought every month and every week up there.
Yeah, you know, I scratched tooth and nail up there. You know, in 2019, even when I led the league in touchdowns, you know, it's like, it's not like we had team success, and it wasn't like it was an easy road to get there. And I'm appreciative of that. I like that. I like that nothing was given to me. And I like that the Argos challenged me every single year after that, you know, bringing in the different competition the next year, different competition the next year. And it truly made me earn it. And more than anything, it made me build an inner confidence and an inner fortitude and an inner identity. Inner fortitude and inner strength and who I am as a football player and who I am as a man and forced me to become a champion internally, right, before I was able to hoist that trophy last year and be given the keys the last 2 years with the Argos. So just appreciative for the whole journey. I don't second guess at all. I know my talent. I know my worth. And that was built over time. And I hope that I can share part of that and be a resource for others to chase their best selves and to chase their best journey and how they can become better men and better people along with becoming a good football player as well.
Are you excited to see the Argos with presumably Chad Kelly here as QB1?
I'm going to be tuning in every game I can. I got so many brothers in that locker room. There's so many wonderful people there. I'll be tuning in and rooting my butt off all the way. So it'll be hard. It'll be different, you know, watching from the outside for sure, but just so much love for so many people in that organization. I'm so grateful for them, and I'll definitely be tuning in and seeing how they're doing.
A couple more here. I'll let you go. Enjoy your time with your family. I appreciate your extended time here. In terms of transitioning back to the CFL, and obviously you've played before, did it take a couple weeks to get going again? Like you said, the CFL game different, wider space, and the, you know, the movement and everything else?
Oh man, definitely. I would love to. I don't know. I'd write a book on it or do a podcast on it. It's just such a different game. It's just simply, you know, the downs alone, right? You get 3 yards on first down. You're immediately in third and seven, right? We're in second seven up there. It's a pressure cooker, right? You got to get the first down right there. But then much less the safeties, right? In the CFL, it's really boundary half, free safety, Sam. So really three safeties on a string, and how hard it is to track three safeties as it is two safeties down south. So it's a more rigid game. Now down south, right, it's a tighter windows. It's a smaller field. Things happen fast. You don't get that yard off the ball that you do in the CFL. It's really a different game. And if you put the Arena League into that mix, right, it's kind of the extremes on either side, right? Now you're going down to 50 yards and 25 yards wide and only eight guys on the field. So I just think there's so many different ways to play the game of football. If you compare it to soccer, it's like futsal and soccer versus indoor soccer versus 11-on-11, you know, outdoor soccer and really great programs like Brazil and you know, Netherlands and Germany, all these programs, they build up from small 3v3, 4v4, 5v5, all the way up to 11v11. And it develops different types of skills. And I think that's what the different games of football does. It develops different type of skills, different types of throws. There's throws that are made in the CFL that aren't made anywhere else, right? You know, the quick out to the field when that corner's off is a 45-yard out throw. It's 45 yards to get 5 yards out there. You don't never see that down here. So I'm just so appreciative of all the different kinds of football. And each one has its uniqueness and its own, you know, beautiful part. So it's just a beautiful game. And I'm appreciative that I've got to play it this long, and hopefully I get going for another couple more years as well.
Yeah, I'm always curious, like, how you view, you know, as someone that's been in all of these, because, you know, we look at anything that's not NFL, right? I cover, like, alternative football, and we just mean that anything that's not the NFL, but then you get, you know, the Canadians get upset, or the, you know, whatever, the USFL or XFL, but it's all trying to give players like you and, you know, all your teammates to these other opportunities. I mean, how do you view kind of the alternative football space with the CFL and the USFL?
It's a big monster, right? There's so many different aspects of it. What I know is that the more football that's being played, the better it is for the game as a whole. That's what I do know. You know, the more opportunities there are for players, coaches, the more opportunity there are for players to sharpen their sword and to perfect their craft. And especially for the quarterback position, you have to play the game to get the experience. You have to be in the fire. You have to be able to feel the edge rush while you're trying to read cover two or cover three. You got to be able to understand, you know, what does that zone blitz feel like? When am I hot off the front side? What, you know, all those things only happen through playing. You can't get those reps in practice. So the more football is being played, the better the game of football is. And you know, the NFL is the big dog, right? And the more leagues there are surrounding it, supporting it, the better product there will be in the NFL. And the better that game will be played. So just the more opportunities there are for football, the better it is for the game. And so the more it happens, I'm all for it.
How important is it to have the support of obviously your family and you know, I say putting up with this. I mean, my wife puts up with a lot of stuff I do, but, you know, just supporting and kind of being there and allowing you to kind of live this journey out.
Oh, I'm forever grateful. My wife, Shanaka, she's a champion. She has her own career going. She could easily be like, what are you doing? You know, kind of shut this down, but she believes in my journey and she supports my dream. So I'm just so appreciative that she's willing to come down, you know, travel to places like Toronto or Birmingham and play this game. And that's what I don't think people appreciate is how much the family goes through for football players. You know, football, it's a roller coaster. It's an emotional roller coaster. It's a dedication. It's the amount of time alone that you push into it, much less the emotional investment. You're riding the highs and the lows of wins and losses. When you see someone make a great play in football, it really is a community behind them. It's, you know, mothers and fathers and brothers and sisters and wives and children supporting them and letting them chase their dreams. So I'm so appreciative of my wife and my daughter and letting me play this game that I love. And hopefully when I play well, it's a reflection on how well they've supported me. And I'm just ecstatic to be able to do it and do it in front of them and with them along my side.
Finally here, kind of moving forward, obviously the goal is always to kind of continue on and the word, you know, leaving the CFL was obviously to be closer to your family, but then also continue to pursue an NFL. Has that changed at all? What are your thoughts with that? And especially how you performed here the first half of the season?
Exactly what you said, right? Who knows? I can't. Obviously, it's here to go win a championship. That's the biggest thing, is go beat the Memphis Showboats this week and then keep that streak going and win as many as we can and win this championship here in the USFL. That's the goal. We want to play at a high level. And then who knows, you know, after that. I'm so fortunate to be at a point in my journey where I truly am chasing my perfect game. You know, I'm truly chasing brotherhood in the locker room, and then how can I perform at that elite level? So 100% where my feet are, and whatever comes out of it, heck yeah. I think I got some more football in me, but I'm not worried about that, not stressed about that, and truly appreciative of this opportunity and chasing my best self along the way.
Yeah, living in the moment here. It's cool just to think of everything you've accomplished in the CFL and the different records and history, and you being a part of all of that. It's got to be pretty cool here sitting at, here in Birmingham now, moving on with the Breakers.
It's been a crazy journey, and I've loved every moment of it, and it hasn't been easy, but hopefully it keeps going, and I'm just hopefully it means something to someone, and it's inspiring along the way, and I'm just appreciative of all the relationships and the people I've met along the way.
Well, McLeod, I appreciate it. Like I said, I remember back the first, we didn't watch the CFL, and I remember watching the Aviators game, and I thought, this guy kind of reminds me of John Moxley, the wrestler. I don't know if you know him, kind of a, carefree intellectual, but kind of hard worker. And I told Paul, my old co-host, I said, this guy is kind of, he's got a little spunk to him. We watched that whole first spring league and covered the shutdown and everything else. It was a wild time, and it's cool to kind of come full circle now and get to talk to you here.
Awesome. Well, appreciate your support, and keep, feeding into this game and doing it the right way and doing the coverage, because, if you're not, we're appreciative of the coverage as well. And we understand that it goes hand in hand with playing and media and how they can support each other and expose each other and get these stories out there. So, keep shining the good light on everything and speaking positively about all these things and these people chasing journeys and chasing their dreams. And like I said, the more football is out there, the better it is for everyone. So I appreciate you doing the coverage and feeding into this beautiful game.
Well, you go enjoy your time in Birmingham. We were there last year. It's delightful. Go have fun at the movies. And thanks again for your time.
Will do. Appreciate you. Go Breakers.
Well, I'm excited to hear a couple reasons. Postseason, catch up, St. Louis Battlehawks player, obviously, and then talking Tré Watson, the signings of the cleats, everything for charity today. How are you doing, sir?
Doing great, man. Having a good time being at home for the offseason. How you doing?
We're good. Yeah, we're done with the championship game. I was in San Antonio, got home late. What's postseason like life for you right now? You said you're back with your family.
Back home in Tampa, man, really just the first focus is trying to get healthy. I was in the CFL and then came right into the XFL. So I played two seasons in a calendar year. So, body's a little banged up, but trying to get healthy first and then go from there, enjoying some family time while we're at it.
Talk about, obviously, and you were with XFL back right in 2020, okay, coming back. What was it like kind of coming back this time?
It was great, man. I looked forward to it. Obviously, besides everything getting cut due to COVID, all my memories from 2020 were so positive and things were really going in a great direction. So this time around, it was really just more the same. Got to play with and against a lot of my teammates from 2020. So that was really cool. Seeing all these familiar faces, guys, still being able to play, 3 years after what happened to us. So from that perspective, it was really exciting. And then just the season itself was wonderful just from start to finish.
We cover obviously the CFL as well on here. What was that transition like? I mean, obviously you played here, but then going up and coming back, what was that like?
It's extremely unique. I think, being a guy who's trying to work your way back to the NFL, you have to be, you have to get in where you fit in. And when COVID happened, there really was nothing else besides the CFL. So in 2021, I went up there. And I went up there again in 2022 and, bounced around a little bit, had some interesting things happen up there. But it's very unique being up there. Obviously, you talk about it on social media and things like that a lot. But just as a player, you have to adapt to so many different things, just even from as simple as currency exchange. There's so many different factors that come into that. Having a home base here down in the United States while playing up there, there's a lot of different factors. So it was nice to be able to come back down. You kind of eliminate a little bit of that hassle. So that from that perspective, I was really happy to do that.
We've started seeing a ton of signings coming out this week, player signings. I was looking at your Twitter and my quarterback, Sea Dragons, Ben DiNucci getting signed, already looks like running into trouble with Sean Payton over there. But how exciting is it seeing, and obviously, you're on the lookout as well, like just seeing all these guys get opportunities here after the season, so quick after the season.
It's great, man. It's what we all work for, and you just can't help but be happy for guys like one of our teammates in St. Louis, Lucas Dennis. I played with him all the way back in 2019 in the Shrine game, and then, you know, follow his career. And when COVID happened, you know, I don't think he was playing at all. Then he goes to the Indoor Football League in Massachusetts, comes right back here, you know, plays in the XFL. And now in a span of a year and a half, he's gone from the Indoor Football League to signing with an NFL team again. You know, that's an amazing story. You know, that's just not something that you see very often. And that's, you know, that's a testament to his hard work and all these other stories of guys doing similar things. It's great to see.
Spending time, obviously, with the Battlehawks, what was that like, both, you know, just on the team and then obviously in the great city and kind of fan base they have?
It was a lot of fun, man. I think, you know, when they called me and told me I was going to be on the team, I was so excited just because I remember how unique the St. Louis atmosphere looked from afar. And I had a couple friends who were on that team in 2020. So I really looked forward to being able to experience it in person. And it was everything I expected and then some. I think, you know, the energy the fan base brought each and every game, even during the weeks, man, on social media, and just seeing how, you know, how much they loved the game, how much they, you know, they had a passion for the city and for us being there. And then the way they were able to support us each and every week, it was pretty awesome.
Well, it must have struck a chord with you. Obviously, you're doing your, you know, fundraiser here, charity. Talk about the inspiration behind the cleats. I know you have some of the cleats as well to show off that you've autographed. Talk us through that.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, style and swag and stuff, that's part of my passion. And I was able to, you know, make that come to life this season with some of my cleats. It's pretty crazy. You know, I was mentioning how the passion the St. Louis fans had. One of them actually just hit me up on Instagram, man. He said, hey, you know, if you have some cleats, could you send them my way and I'd make a custom for you? And he's actually a local St. Louis artist named Brock Seals. And, you know, people hit you up on social media all the time. And most of the time, you know, you really think nothing of it, especially when they're, you know, soliciting things like that just out of nowhere, not asking for money and things like that. I didn't think anything of it, but I said, hey, you know, I'll try it out. And lo and behold, it turned into a great partnership. He made four amazing pairs of cleats for me. So right here, this was the very first one that I got made for our home opener in week four. You know, pretty cool shoe. Got the Battlehawk wings on there. And then, you know, as soon as that game ended, the first text after the game was, hey, you want to do another one? Hey, you got some more? And then, you know, it turned into a season-long thing. So, like, I have a pair of Travis Scott's that I got to wear a couple times. Those are pretty cool. You know, some Dior 1 Lows, which are, you know, everyone wants those. They're not in my budget, the real shoe anyway. And then got to finish off the season in week 10 with the Kobe's. So, you know, what I took from that, obviously I got to enjoy having some pretty cool stuff. And I got to make some amazing memories, you know, each and every week that we played in St. Louis. So the whole concept for doing this charity auction was, how can I, you know, give off what I've been essentially blessed with and those experiences? How can I translate that into someone else's experience through the game of football? And there's no better place to start that than with youth sports and being able to give kids opportunities to make their own memories and find their own path, both on the football field and off the football field. And working with the media department and everyone in St. Louis, you know, they brought this organization to me and said, hey, you know, they've been around for such a long time, the Matthews Dickey Boys and Girls Club of St. Louis. And they said, hey, they do amazing things through football, being able to, you know, help. I think they have like 20 plus teams worth of kids that they're able to sponsor. So this was just, you know, a small way for me to be able to give back to them. I said, hey, you know, I know St. Louis fans would love these cleats. I'm sure, you know, collectors all around the, you know, the country would love them. So, you know, maybe this is a small way that I can, you know, help create these memories for another kid, you know, through the game of football. Because at the end of the day, that's what it's all about. And, you know, as much as, you know, the fans appreciate us and you know, they say how much they enjoy games, it really does mean a lot to guys like me. Like, I don't take it for granted that, you know, 35, almost 40,000 people showed up to watch us play each and every home game. Like, that's really special. And when a kid comes up and asks you for an autograph and things like that, it really does mean a lot, really, for me, just as much for them, because only so many people ever get opportunities like that. So I really appreciate each and all those moments.
And so we have, and I'll obviously put the link in the YouTube, everything. The GoFundMe will go through next Friday. You know, this will air this week, and then there'll be another week to do that. Bidding seems to be going well already. I went on there and kind of checked that out. How cool is that just to see that this is resonating, obviously, with people you're trying to put, you know, positive energy out there?
It's remarkable, man, because, you know, even with having the idea, having a great organization to do all these things with, it still has to be executed by individuals, you know, out there who are willing to put up that money and help support. So even just last night, I wanted to look for the first time and see, and bids were over $150, $175, $200 plus dollars. You know, and I started doing the math. There was already, I think, $700 total in committed money for the Boys and Girls Club. And that's just awesome, man. It shows that people care. And it, you know, it validates the, you know, the whole point behind doing this is to be able to help other people. And it's all coming together well.
Well, what I like about it too is, you know, the XFL, and obviously you spent time in the CFL, we talked, is that more of a connection, right, that the fans have with the teams, and they do feel like that, you know, kind of partial ownership of, you know, especially St. Louis, like, this is our team. I spent time in DC this year for a game as well. You know, these, you know, guys and girls and kids and whatever, that are watching you guys, it's just different than the NFL. It's a different level of commitment. And I think that you giving back in this way is really exciting. And obviously the Battlehawk fans or whoever, but I would imagine that, you know, probably some St. Louis, you know, guys want those cleats.
No, absolutely. It's a unique perspective, not, you know, not being in the NFL, not having teams that are, you know, have 100 plus years of history, even college sports have that as well. So I definitely got to experience that a little bit in the CFL. You know, you have unique places where they have unique attachments to their teams, and they develop, you know, their own energy for that. And the XFL has done that as well. You know, DC, like you mentioned, with the lemons and the beer snake and all those things like that, all those little traditions, those are all developed naturally among, you know, small groups of people who said, hey, this is coming to our city. It means something to us. And you know, you see it translate when they show up for those games. And that's what St. Louis did for us. So it's definitely awesome to see. And, you know, this is just a small way to be able to reciprocate that back.
Looking here to the future, obviously, you know, trying to get to the next steps, how would you look back at your time in the XFL here in 2023?
You know, really, it was just a blessing overall, man. I think I came out of Canada extremely frustrated with my 2022 experience, just because for the first time in my career, really ever, I got hurt. And it wasn't just a, you know, hey, I'll be back next week and it'll be fine. It was, hey, you know, I actually have to figure some things out. So it was almost a bit of a gamble to go into the XFL when I did. But, you know, fortunately, Dave Bowler and Coach Becht and Donnie Abraham gave me a chance. And I was able to make the team and contribute. Maybe not in the way that I would have been if I were, you know, fully healthy and felt the way I wanted to feel. But at the end of the day, you know, the experience was great from start to finish. My teammates were amazing. The league is, as a whole, was just enjoyable. And that's what you want. It's hard to get sometimes as a professional athlete. It's so business oriented, and it's extremely transactional from the player perspective. You know, you can be signed, you can be cut, you can be traded, you can be all these things literally any given day of the week. And you see it happen so often. So you sometimes lose the personal aspect when you're going through these different leagues and things like that. So really just thankful at the end of the day, man. I enjoyed being able to contribute. You know, we had an amazing season. Ended really unfortunately. You know, I'm sick that I wasn't able to be there for that second Seattle game. But, you know, family comes first. So we were enjoying a wedding during that time period. And, you know, the chips fell where they did, but at the end of the day, man, it was just a great experience.
Last question. We had Cole Kublik on this episode as well, talking from ESPN, and, you know, he had really high remarks talking about Coach Becht and everybody from St. Louis. You know, we were kind of running down coaches that, you know, impressed. What was your thoughts just on the staff overall that the Battlehawks had, you know, starting with Becht all the way down, that had working with you guys?
I think they were great, man, top to bottom. You know, you had so many guys with not only just, you know, football experience, but high level NFL playing experience, all pro, Pro Bowl type experience. You know what I mean? From Coach Donnie to Coach Prohl, Coach Becht, obviously, Coach Glove, you know, was a Pro Bowl D lineman for the Cowboys. So you have all these different names, and I left out even some more, but you have all these different names, and they really came together and just made it an enjoyable experience. You know, when you're building a team from scratch and you had like, what, 3.5 weeks to form a team, they did a great job of doing that. And, you know, we went through some things throughout the year, as any team does, but I'd say even more so this year. And, you know, created relationships that'll last beyond just this football season. So for that, I commend them and you know, would play for them any day.
Well, I encourage anyone, go check out the GoFundMe. Cool, you know, XFL memorabilia, cool just sports memorabilia across the board. Appreciate it, Trey. I think it's really cool. And obviously, best of luck with everything that comes next. But I know that, like we've talked about, St. Louis is loves you guys and a kind of overwhelming response. I'm excited to see that continue.
Absolutely. Thank you. I appreciate it, man.
Huge special thanks to all of our guests, all seven of them coming on today. Obviously, Mike Mitchell working in time with his family, work, everything else Mike has going on. Super appreciate Bill Shea taking time, you know, talking through his article, his thoughts on the XFL and the USFL as it stands right now. Cole Kublik making time through all of his radio shows and everything else, his appearances. And then obviously Jim Mullin, really appreciate that. And Jim helping us, like I said, kind of turn the page, getting back to CFL coverage here and, you know, and finishing up the USFL, but, you know, getting through coverage here into the summer. Really appreciate McLeod taking a lot of time on his day off, spending time with his wife and child, taking time to come on the podcast. And then Tré Watson, I think that's great what Trey's doing. You know, the XFL, I've always said this a little bit more, like the CFL, you know, we're working with the communities, the fans, getting them involved. And I think it's great that Trey had such a good time in the XFL with the Battlehawks that he wanted to give back to the city there. So should do it for me today. I know it was a long one, getting back into everything else, USFL and CFL, but I hope this episode kind of can exist for a little while here. Little evergreen, full XFL 2023 season review. And what do we make about that? A plane is flying overhead, a helicopter of some sort. So I will get out of here. Like and subscribe. Take care.